agenda, but first, issue is the minutes of October 25th, which Corey sent out the other day. There was one thing on there that I saw, I don't know if anybody else had any comments on that.
There was, maybe just one, I think it's supposed to be on the covert projects.
Okay.
On page three, section three.
I don't know if one thing, I don't think it really matters, but it's, instead of saying yay, it says a, A-Y-E.
Aye.
Instead of Y-A-E. It really matters.
And I had one on the very end, Corey, the third paragraph under miscellaneous. It said, Kay St. Clair then nominated Dean Knowles and was seconded by Vern Coder, Denise accepted. But it doesn't say what she was nominated for or what she accepted.
And on page three, I've got one. Says Charlie Dion asked for an inventory of all vehicles, type and age. Suzanne asked him to email him after the meeting, and I said at the meeting, I don't email.
Oh, you were, I thought it was a girl.
No, I don't.
Okay.
I'm old school. That was all.
Right. Anybody else? So we want to have a motion to accept once they're amended, or?
Accept the minutes.
I'll make a motion to accept it with the changes that have been passed.
I'll send it.
And all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And we have the three budgets, and this is not in any, I didn't pick an order, so I don't know if there's any preference, if anybody has a preference.
I think one department is showing its preference.
Yes.
Okay, is that all right? Okay, so we're only a fire show first.
I do have, can I just drop this among, I do have a few copies, if people would like a copy.
What is it there?
You have a phone with you?
I have.
Is that the only one, Suzanne, is that the amended copy that you did?
That is the one that, yes.
Yeah, I got the same thing, and it's not enough.
Should be exactly the same.
The one that's second, yeah. I got those two.
You do?
If you're short, I got it.
Well, it's so small.
Ed, do you need one?
I gave him one.
Okay.
I gave him one.
Oh. You're on.
I'm on. Well, I'm not, if we can send, if you want to just start that one around, it's kind of got a cover letter on the top of it and what my presentation's going to start with. Basically, mine is, it's going to be pretty short and sweet. There's only two items, as you see there, that we're asking for a change on. Everything else will be level funded. Then I'll kind of explain a little bit on them and field your questions.
Yeah, Mark, the only difference is you have is a $40,000 on the salary firefighters, and Suzanne has it at $41,000.
Correct.
That's it.
Correct. I'll go with hers on that line, but we'll see. I'll start with the training line first. Like I said, these are the only two that are going to change. And on the second page is our basic line items that we work off of for the year. I'm going to start with the training side of things. 65 is what we've had for the last couple of years, and I'm going to ask for $500 more because of the need to constantly keep up with our training. And when I get to the next one and start talking about personnel, it ties directly into the training end. There's a training class which is starting tomorrow evening. being posted by Northborough Fire Department. And it's for certification in level one and level two. In order to be a certified firefighter, you need to obviously have the level one. They're gonna go to the next step, which is level two. I've enrolled three people that have since kind of made inquiries into the fire department, would like to become members. And the only way they can do that is to sit through the training. And the training, and then we have another individual who's already got his level one, never finished level two, so he's gonna go through and finish his level two. So we're gonna send four people to this training class. And the cost for the training class itself, it runs from November until the June. It's like 6 months long for them to finish all of the training, is $700 per person. So that's coming right off the front of everything here. And never mind the other training that we need to do during the year. And we can't expend the whole line because I may have some people that show up during the year that we would like to add on to the rolls. And they would have to go through the same type of class to get the certification. Not everybody that walks through the door, actually very few that walk through the door, because there's very few walking through the door anymore, have the required certifications that they need in order to become, or for us to put them on a fire truck and then be able to perform the job and the duties required. So that's why we're asking for that little bit, because we're taking some right off the top, right from the beginning. Normally we'll pick up these classes, because the state runs an awful lot of these in the spring and the fall. This is one that's local, which is a huge benefit. We have people that normally have to travel to Concord or further to get these classes. And it's two nights a week plus Saturdays. So these guys make a huge commitment all on their own for 6 months to become certified. So, huge commitment.
Can you just repeat the numbers of one and two levels again?
Numbers?
Yeah, that's how many times.
Oh, three are going to be taking their level one. And one has his level one, but he never finished his level two, so he's going to be able to sit through the class and then test out at the end on his level two.
Okay.
So there's two different certifications that these individuals will earn. Most of the time when you take these classes, you come out with just a level one. They're going to have a level two, which is going to put them in even higher level, which is, of course, a much larger benefit for us as a department and for the community, because their skills will be that much better.
Now, the three that are going, they're just going for the level one, or are they going
They're going
for
the whole
two?
Class. They're going
okay.
to be doing the whole thing. So
okay, that's what I thought.
Come
I
June, when they test out, we've had four people at level two, which is a lot more than some of the individuals at on the department have now. So these
okay.
guys will be more certified than they were.
Joe?
Is there a level three?
Not anymore.
No. So two is it?
In the old days, when I started, we used to start with a level one, then you had a career, you had a level two, and you had a level three. That's the stuff that I did, because I've been doing this now for 35 years. Since then, they've taken a lot of those classes and combined it into a one and a two. The level three certification, the old level three had things like vehicle extrication, high angle rescue, building collapse, all that stuff was on a three level. They've taken some of that and put it in the two, but now if you want those extra certifications, you take a class just for that. You become a rescue technician,
rescue
specialist, swift water technician, extrication certifications. They've kind of changed a little bit just because there's so much involved in all these levels of training now. They can focus on just those individuals, more concentrated and give you more skills.
I'm going to continue a conversation we had before. How many people do you have on your rolls? Not counting you and the assistant fire chief.
22.
How many of them live within 10 minutes of the fire station?
Three.
And of the other people, we are paying for training for those other people who may live much further away.
That's
Is that
correct.
Correct.
That's correct.
So in an emergency, if my house was burning, you only got three people plus yourself and the assistant chief.
That's correct.
Okay.
We've had this discussion before.
Yes, we have.
Most of the fire department members live out of town.
Well, they can live out of town, but they can still be within 10 minutes of the fire station.
Yes, but there's very few of them that are. Depending on time of day and with traffic for them to get there within 10 minutes, it's pretty difficult. There's three of us right now at that close.
Well, maybe it's time to speak the heresy that actually Bill brought it up first, regionalization. Considered it?
Considered many times.
We ought to consider it seriously.
Regionalization has been tried by a lot of other fire departments, a lot bigger than we are. Huge fire departments, from the Dover to the Rochester to the Portsmouth. And then they'll tell you that it won't really work. But if you want to go regionalization, and we're talking funding for what we're looking at here, put this 10 times over for you to go regionalization.
Well, if you want to carry that further, and I spend $127,000 on the fire department, but you don't have enough people to man the fire trucks to get to my house to put out a fire, what good is that $127,000?
They have mutual aid. All the surrounding towns are mutual aid. You can get there in that time factor. I mean, you need to take that into consideration. People work. There are volunteers, Vern. They're not full-time people.
Yeah.
And they have an agreement with all of the surrounding towns, and if they can't get a tech, they have some automatically come, especially structural
well,
repairs.
Well, the thing with mutual aid is I don't think everybody totally understands how mutual aid works. And Vern, if you want to argue over 127, then you come on down and join the fire department and help us out. You can get there in 10 minutes.
I couldn't pass the physical.
You can get there in 10 minutes.
Oh, yes,
anybody,
I can.
You know, we can use all the help we can get.
Yeah, but I'd probably drop dead from heart attack.
Yes, let's stop the back and forth.
My follow-up, and then I'm done, is mutual aid and regionalization are just synonyms for the same thing, which is...
No, they're not.
Oh, no,
they're cooperative
not.
Efforts.
No, they're not. They're 100, they're opposite ends of the spectrum between regionalization and mutual aid. They do not mean the same thing.
Okay.
If regionalization was such a workable component, why is it not already done?
Because people like their territories.
And that's true to some extent. But the reason why a lot of that's not done is just because in this area, it does this not happen to fit. It fits very good out in California, West Coast, around D.C. and whatnot. It doesn't work up here.
Just a sort of a follow-up. I mean, you know, other places in the United States have built strong county governments, and counties provide both these kinds of services. We didn't grow up this way. It does make it difficult for small towns like ours, but that's the historical piece. And this is where we are right now. In order to change that model, you just need to have a concerted effort and a study, lots of study and lots of commentary and lots of input. It's not going to happen during a budget review.
No, that's something that's going to take a lot more than us sitting here talking about each other. But let me just expound one thing on the mutual aid part that Vern seems to understand and what Denise has brought up. Mutual aid is there, and that's something that everybody in this area has to have in order to function. There isn't a single fire department in this state that does not have enough people to go out and handle a large fire or an extensive emergency. It doesn't happen. It's not there. Everybody has mutual aid. But mutual aid is only for specific things. Mutual aid is not for, so I can't get three people or I can't man a fire truck. I cannot call mutual aid if I'm going to a CO detector activation, a medical aid call. Those kind of things are supposed to be handled by your fire department. You cannot call mutual aid for that. In order to have mutual aid, you need to be able to provide mutual aid. Our mutual aid is set up so that if we have a structure fire, smoke in a building, chimney fire, an extensive extrication from an automobile accident, we have set up programs in place for mutual aid to respond. Only because we just don't have enough people. Nobody does. So they will come in at our request. One of us, Kevin, myself, one of the other officers will show up. We're going to go over a multiple alarm incident. We have standard run cards so we know who's coming. But we cannot call mutual aid. If somebody has a burn in their backyard or they don't like what somebody has, can't call South Burwick or Dover to come and check on something because it may take us a little bit of time to get there. It's not going to happen. Or if it does, you know what's going to happen with that afterwards? They're going to hand you a bill. Because they're not going to be able to run over here. Because when they leave their community and cover somebody else, what do they have to do? They got to fill in their own people. So when that fire truck leaves, they're going to put on a recall or a box, whatever they want, and they're going to be back their people to cover their community. That's the standard practice. That's what everybody does. So if they have to do that, starting to work on it, it's going to take away their budget, which they don't have money for if it constantly occurs over and over and over. There's some local fire departments in our area that have done this extensively where they've had to respond to other communities when they've been very busy. And it drains their budget and their overtime accounts.
Okay.
other city managers have gone to their fire chiefs and said, you're not going anywhere. We cannot fund it. So what that does, it takes them, one of your responses, if you're on the first or second one, they just move you down and move you down and move you down. There's a lot of things that happen. That's not good for anybody's, for their morale, because these, the people that are in these positions in these communities, they want to go and they want to help. But because they can't, because of the budgetary constraint, that affects the whole way things flow.
Do you do the explorers, right? Has that helped you as far as getting town kids that grow up and stay, or they're growing up and going?
Yes and no. Yes and no. I want to see a lot more. It's cyclic. There's times when we'll have a dozen, and there's times when we'll go down, what we got now, 6, 7?
Where do you solicit it, though? Do you go to the schools and...
We've actually had guys that have gone to Summersworth and have gone to Dover, they've had a presentation. They'll go to get the kids that fit the age group for the model, and they will try to recruit. Have you got a lot? Not a lot. I teach at the high school, Dover High School, as a CTC program. I recruited, I don't know how many, about 15, 18 from that program, because it's a level one certification program, and they've come to our fire department, and they're the ones right now that are the staple that keep that fire department manned. It's because of these people that have been able to find. But it's not anything that, it's a feeder, but it's nothing that we can rely on to keep our manning levels at what it should be. It just doesn't have the staying power. Because what happens is a lot of these kids are high school kids and younger, and then they get done with high school, you know, they've got to get a job, and you've got to go pay for the car, they got to have a girlfriend, so all these life changes reflect their availability. So it's hard to keep them, sometimes even hard to keep motivated. They get to a point where it's like, this ain't for me. This isn't for everybody. There's very few people that want to do what you do.
And I just have one follow-up, and I'm trying to go. When you send somebody to these classes, you said this one person never finished. So what happens when, let's say, some of these people don't finish and they disappear mid-class, or who puts the bill?
They do.
They do.
The only way that the fire department will reimburse them is they need to come to us and show us the certificate of completion. Okay. And we don't pay for 100% of the class. The way that I've set it up is the fact that we'll pay for half of it, but we don't. You gotta have some ownership in it, and then you have to be able to give us something in return, which means we've drawn up a contract that they have to give us a year of their time to get some of that back.
Charlie?
Okay, I'm gonna start off with a simple question. First of all, just because I ask about salary doesn't mean I'm against it. But why is a salary over 2%? Can you explain that, for one? And two, is why the select board get another 1,000.
As far as the percentage goes, I put numbers in there that I figure we need to work in the reason.
No, I just need
that. Okay. Yep, whatever the percentage was. I didn't look at it, the percentage line, and I know that's what you people work in. I gave it a number. And the reason why I've given it that, and why the select board has upped it from what we discussed, I've had some discussions with the select board about manning and personnel within the fire department. And you talk about explorers and whatnot. We've had one, and I know of another, that have been on our fire department and have since. It's a competition in the area for anybody to get somebody to come and work on your fire department. We've talked about this before. I think everybody in this room understands that we hardly pay our people minimum wage. That's one reason why I keep trying to add a little to this. We can at least say minimum wage. I know of one individual, and there's one who has an application sitting on the desk in South Florida. They pay him $14 an hour to walk through the door. We're lucky we can pay him $7 or $8. So, if any of you are sitting here in your job, are you going to do the same job for $10,000 when over here I can get $20,000 for it? This is what we're up against. The fact that every time we go to an incident, everybody can stand there and realize, this guy's making at least $14, and these people are making $20. These guys are on overtime from some other city, and they're making $30. Same job. There's no difference in what everybody's doing. But in order for us to keep people, and it's already shown, we are losing them because we cannot compensate them. It's that simple. That's why. And in reality, we're just scratching the surface here as far as salaries go.
I understand that. I just wanted to bring the point up.
Yep.
I realize you've got problems.
Because if we don't...
But if I didn't bring it up at this meeting, you know, when we come to another meeting, we don't get the chance to ask
it. No, no, bring it on.
And that's why I ask questions.
Bring it on. Anybody bring it on. But I've got ways to go with it.
Well, it's just a comment on what Chief Rutherford has just said, and that is that the unemployment rate in the Seacoast is low, and we are dealing with that not just in the fire department, but throughout city or municipal government. We're trying to hire people at the rates that we pay them, and we're up against not competitive with rates in the surrounding either municipalities for the same jobs or equivalent jobs in private industry, for example. So it's a difficult situation. You know, we're slogging it uphill.
I came in with the 40. I've had this discussion, like I said, with the select board. So they see where I'm coming from, and they've added that extra $1,000. The other thing is, when we get done with this and we get to the end of the budget cycle, and I'm sitting in a meeting with my people, I can at least tell them that the town will support what they're doing. What am I supposed to do? Walk in there and say, no, you guys are getting nothing. So what kind of message does that send to people that are supposed to be coming in, giving up their time, could be sitting at Thanksgiving dinner, Christmas tree, in the shower, sitting on a can, and a call comes in and you need to respond? What kind of messages are we sending to these people?
All I said was I just wanted an explanation.
Well, I'm kind of going a little further with your explanation, okay?
You're assuming that I'm against it?
No, I'm not assuming anybody's against it.
As long as you understand where I'm coming from.
I am not assuming anybody's against it. I've been down the road a little bit. This is like the sixth year I've been sitting here, and I know there's people in this room that don't want to compensate anybody in the community for anything they do. I know that. I've heard it. I'm just trying to keep this thing afloat, to keep the fire department viable, is where I'm going. Question? I saw your hand up.
Yeah. You have to check the call, Michelle.
I didn't see the hand.
Oh, it's not.
Oh, go ahead.
Just a couple questions. First, I want to comment that we're all here as volunteers. So we have a volunteer fire department.
You're elected.
We're volunteers.
You're an elected official.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We don't put our name on the ballot expecting to get paid for it. So we're volunteers, is what I'm saying. We have a volunteer fire department. I acknowledge it's a dangerous job. I'm not saying it should get increased, but remember, we're public servants. We're doing this as volunteers. Okay? That's what I have to say about that part. The other part I have to say is, why does the annual report reflect a different number in the appropriation to the salaries than what's on this report? So the report you gave us for 2017 appropriation is $2,000 higher than what was in the annual report as an appropriation.
So, can I respond?
Yes.
So what are you looking at?
So if you look in the annual report, the appropriation for salaries is $36,580. In your report, you're starting at $38,580. So there's a $2,000 discrepancy in what was appropriated and what you say is already appropriated. So that's $2,000 more already.
The right hand is 38,580.
So the report is 36,643.
Do you want to continue and want to look at the meeting?
If you look at the attachment you sent out this afternoon, Suzanne, it's that number, 36,643.
Well, the 36,580 was the one that we went to press with, which was the budget committees. But the town voted back in all of the budget cuts that had been voted on by the budget committee. So the town, when we reported it to the DRA, we had 38,580. If you look at the note that's on that line, that was the select board's recommended
amount. Okay. All right. So the $2,000 in salary increases that removed by the budget committee last year got approved.
Well, not as a line, but the town put back, made whole the bottom line of the operating budget that the select board had recommended, not the one that the budget committee recommended. And so, you know, the budget committee can, I mean, the, we can move things back and forth at will. But in fact, when we had submitted our proposal to the budget committee and to the town, it was on that line, $38,580. So that's how we...
So that's the discrepancy in what went out in the town report and what the actual...
Yes, because this isn't, we hadn't voted yet.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
So yes.
So
they were unspecified budget cuts, if you remember. It was just there'll be no budget increase. That was the direction that we were given. There'll be no 2% budget increase. So we went down and we took 2% out of all of them.
Yeah.
That's where it came from. And then it still didn't equal the amount that the budget committee wanted to cut. So then we put down this line about unspecified because we didn't know where the budget committee wanted those cuts to come from.
Go ahead.
I don't understand what you... It was a 2% across the board last year. Yes.
So, well, no, I'm just looking at the bottom line number. So it was 2,000 last year, and then it's another 2,000 this year, is what we're talking about. Last mark. Is that correct, Mark?
That is correct. Well, I changed it from 38, and I was going to go to 40, and then the select board wished it to go to 41.
Okay. So...
It's an increase of $2,420.
And how many employees does that cover? Will it cover?
24.
24. So it's less than 100 workplaces.
Sounds about right.
And also, that line increased because remember we discussed it, the salaries of the fire chief and his compensation to be able to get in calls. So that had to go in that line. So that's the additional expense. It was from last year, the fire chief's salary going up as well as in pay for his calls.
Mm-hmm.
That would show up in the firefighter salary line.
Okay. So we're talking about $100 each for each firefighter this year?
Roughly. Depends on who's there and when. That's how our system
is. Is it vary or is it across the board? Like, how do you determine
it? It's varied because they get compensated by being there. I can tell you, sitting, we have 22 people on our rolls. We have, in order for them to get their full compensation, they need to be there 50% of the calls. There's some people that I'm lucky. If we do, what do we have, 140 calls?
Yeah.
Probably have some people that haven't been there for 10 for various reasons. Myself and Kevin here, we show up probably 85, 90% of the time just because we do. So in order for them to get their compensation, they earn a point for their hours that they're there. So we say, oh, everybody's going to get $100. And if he's not there, somebody's not going to get paid. It's that simple. But the people that are there all the time, they are going to be a little bit on the higher end of the scale because that's how the point system, how we deal it out, works. It just depends on how often you're there. And it's hard because, again, we'll just keep going with those manpower issues. We had a very good, solid turnout most of the time. I'm starting to track calls and how many people are there. We had a call to Dover 6 weeks ago, a couple months ago. We could not answer a mutual aid call.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was the middle of the day, it was 3:30 in the afternoon. It was for a structure fire and went to multiple alarms. And we're on their first run card. So as soon as they have a working fire, we respond. I was working in Lee. Heard the call. I left my paid job and came back here to answer the call, along with another person who works with me who's on the fire department. We have a few people that are cleared from to leave their work to come to assist the fire department. But there's only a handful of us that can do that. So if we're talking daytime, 8 to 4, and everybody's doing their normal work, that's where we're starting to see some staffing shortages. And I have that one incident where we could not even answer. So you have to call Dover and say, sorry, we cannot fill that. They'll find somebody else. And when those things continue, then we just go further and further down. That's just not something that we want to get involved in because we won't get mutual aid from that's a fire department that sits next door, that's manned with 14 guys on shift all the time. All of a sudden, we can't answer their call for help. When we want it, they're going to say, sorry, sorry. So if we got to start going down this road, the communities that come and help us, the Somersworths, the Dovers, the Rochesters, aren't going to be as available. So we need to be able to fulfill our commitment. One sec, please. There's been a couple of calls where we've had one person respond. Again, daytime. And I do not want to see one person going on any call by themselves for anything. I always want at least two on any fire truck or any vehicle that we run. For all kinds of reasons. Safety being the number one reason. And we've had some incidents where we have not been able to have but more than one person. And this is starting to become a trend. And it's starting to really start to surface in the daytime hours. At nighttime, everyone's home. Weekends, most people are around. We get a call, we can get a truck on the road in 5 minutes. Pretty consistent. I'll expand in a second. Go ahead, we have your question.
How many, you said that you had three right now within the response, the 10-minute response, right? How many did you have a year ago and maybe 2 years ago?
I mean, as far as people only responding?
Respond.
It's starting to, I mean, one or two, it was not as prevalent, but I'm starting to see a trend in the very short term and in the last few months where that is starting to increase. And then knowing my personnel, knowing their jobs and their commitments, it's not going to change. We have a few members on the fire department who work for ambulance services, who work for other fire departments. So they're doing shift work. So if a call comes in on a Thursday, there may be five of them around. But if the call comes in on a Wednesday, I know that everybody's busy. And it may be one, and it may be him. Very hard to gauge on that stuff, on who's coming in. The biggest thing that I carry around is I get a call, and I leave my house or I'm someplace, and the first thing runs to me, how many do I got? Who's coming? What day of the week? So I'm carrying that burden 100% of the time, 365 days a year. When a call comes in, how many people are going to be there to help me? I've gone on calls a whole bunch of times for myself. I have enough confidence that I'm not going to put myself in a situation where I'm going to compromise my safety. Or I can call for the need. Some of these individuals that went were just certified, were just firefighters. They don't have the time, the skill, the experience to make some of the decisions. But we have to place them in because we have to have somebody go. And these are the kind of things that we're starting to see as a trend within the fire department.
Chief, I don't know if this will, you can briefly address this, but what are we looking at? I mean, what's the answer?
The answer is it's not going to be too far down the road, but there's going to have to be some people in the firehouse all the time. Daytime coverage is not that far down the road. And it may be me and you asking for it in a year or two. If this trend continues and we start having these issues where we can't meet our responsibilities, that means something that we have to look at. We're the only fire department in the area outside of Madbury does not have people manned during daytime. South Florida doesn't do it. Of course, that's not a state that they are going to be very close to. Everybody else has somebody. At least doing daytime coverage. Most of them are 24/7.
With the firefighter one and two certifications, is that something the young people, men and women, that get that? Are they looking for a career in fire service?
Yeah, we're not the most.
So we could keep them. Assuming we went that way, this would be another path for them?
Yeah.
Possibly?
Yep. Yeah. We still have people that have been with us that are on other fire departments that will still have that loyalty.
Yep.
That stays with us. Their availability has been cut in half.
Right.
But they're at least not forgetting where they came from. Yeah. That's kind of something I throw at them an awful lot. We've got you, you start. Don't forget where you came from. Don't hear me say that all the time. I know he does. And, but the thing is we're a stepping stone for a lot of this stuff. We're a call fire department. You know, the term volunteer is gone. Everybody wants to call it a volunteer fire department, or anybody a volunteer fire department. That's not that anymore. Nobody's going to come in under that term volunteer. I already explained the issue of compensation and why we're losing people. So this is just kind of the road that we're headed.
Thank you.
I just want to bring up a point I brought up last year that don't have a volunteer.
I don't consider it a volunteer fire department.
But again, that's something that I think you guys need to figure out what, where you want to be.
Or paid on call individuals, that's the way I look at it.
Then they'd have to have at least minimum wage.
And that's where I've been trying to go, that's why I've been throwing these numbers at me, I'm not coming here asking for $10,000. We know what the, our quarterly is, and Kevin does a lot of the payroll stuff, and when we get down and we submit it, I ask him where we're at, which is, oh, we're at $750 this quarter, or we're at $8 this quarter.
$7.25, and the other piece that I would look at as well, is what does that do to your workers' compensation? Because as volunteers, they're covered automatically as firefighters, I don't know if it changes at all if they're considered employee firefighters. Just throwing that out there, something to look at, as far as premiums, you know, they would be covered no matter what.
I think that they, I mean, our insurer is aware of it, because we, they're on payroll, they're paid, so I end up salaries and earnings in it a little bit. So I think they are included in that calculation of what we pay.
Right, I would just check, because with fire departments, typically, they do supply what would be called a stipend, you know, a point system, like you're saying, would go through payroll, a lot of departments do that. But it could be in a volunteer stipend position, so, you know, it's just figuring out which way you want to go, that's all. Because you kind of, it sounds like you're in a flux there, and you're going to go one way or the other.
Aye, Captain.
You and I've had that discussion, you sent me that information before, and I understand that fully.
Right.
And it's kind of tiptoeing through some things here, I mean, we're trying to stay afloat with what we're asking for and doing here, but there's going to have to be some changes, it's coming. I mean, I'm trying not to, you know, make it a disaster, because it's not, and we're trying to manage that now, do as best we can to keep us afloat like we are. The community as a whole, I mean, we had some big issues, and we solved some of them last year, when the community stepped up and addressed our needs for equipment. We were on borderline with what we had, and now we've gotten past that. Our new fire truck is going to arrive in 3 weeks, and that's going to make a big difference in our fire department, what our capabilities are. Well, the next thing that has to be addressed is going to be a manpower issue, and how the community decides to do it. I've had the discussion with the select board, and they said, maybe you need to put a committee together, and do a committee, and do this, or do that, start looking at things. It's not that far away, it's really not.
I mean, I would just be interested if maybe next year, or even before next year, throwing some numbers together of what that would look like, you know, what does that mean? Do you need two people every day, and what would be that cost, just so that the committee would have an idea of what could be coming down the pike, versus waiting until we're in an emergency situation and going, you know, here we go.
I've already been there, I can start throwing numbers.
Yeah, I mean, I think everybody here would appreciate that.
Yeah, well, as Chief Rutherford said, I mean, we have strategized that the best way to manage this is to have a community group to look at the situation, see what surrounding communities do, and come up with a proposal that we can use next year for budget season or earlier.
Yes, Ken.
So our population hasn't changed in 34 decades, but the number of calls has changed now? Is it more attrition that we're concerned about?
Call volume is cyclic. I can't tell you if it's going to be 150 or 500. It all depends. I mean, there's no way to predict that.
Bob gives call numbers at the end.
It can't be based on what the town's population is, because our majority of our calls are mutual aid to other communities. That's where our calls are. Dover's 40,000 people. South Berwick's 15,000 people.
So we're paying for mutual aid, basically.
In a roundabout way, we are. But if we don't supply it, we don't get it.
Can you provide calls for us at the end of each year, like Bob does? I'm sorry, Chief.
I do. It's in the report.
It's in the report.
Try your name with the report. Every year, what we go to.
Bill.
Is it fair to say, though, over the past couple decades, there isn't the same number of people in town that could become firefighters and have the time and the, you know, the ability to do that? Is that a fair statement?
Well, it is, because when I first got on the fire department, the majority of the people lived in the town.
Right.
And that has just gone down and down and down. And again, a lot of that, and people that have been around for a long time, have been a career or are a career firefighter someplace else. And we've managed to stay loyal and work within our community to serve and protect our community.
Is it also true that the job has become much more technical than it used to be, and people that in the past may have said, hey, yeah, I'll join the fire department, now they're saying, way too much going on?
Yeah, that's 100% right. So much more. There are so many more hoops that you need to jump through in order to become certified than it was before. I mean, just the standards that we have to meet have completely changed. I mean, I used to wear a rubber coat and a 3/4-inch boot, and I was ready to go. I didn't need anything else. Nowadays, I have to wear gear that's rated a certain thing. I have to wear an air pack that's going to do a certain thing for me. I have to meet a physical condition standard. And I can give you a list of 20 standards that we have to do every year. And how is somebody that's trying to do a regular job, support a family or whatnot, or try to get ahead, have to do that? Above and beyond what everybody else is doing. We're not in dire straits by any means, so I'm not trying to paint something here, a picture that's, you know, we're going to collapse. We're not. We're working hard. Kevin and I and some of the other individuals do an awful lot to try to get people, try to do the recruitment thing, and try to keep this where we're headed. But it's not going to survive for a hell of a lot longer. We have a lot of kids that are going to, like I said, they've got life changes. Situations are changed, their availability is not there, it's starting to show. And rather than wait until we are behind the eight ball, I'm trying to be a little bit proactive and at least get this out there. It's something that the town is going to have to address. And like I said, I've had a discussion with the select board. This is probably the next group that needs to know about it, because it's coming.
Well, and I think socially it's not what it used to be, where people lived and worked near, you know, you lived and you worked nearby, people could leave their jobs. It's a different time on top of nobody there to, you know, with a 2% rate, people are busy doing their own thing.
Well, a lot of what we do, and we call mutual aid places, I've had a discussion with other fire chiefs, and it's just something that's kind of just not right. I don't know, like you said, a generational thing. There's a lot of young people that work in the fire departments around here, and when they put on a recall or strike a box, fire departments call back their own individual employees. They don't even come back. Mm. And when they and we're talking overtime rates, that these guys can make $35, $40 an hour, and they don't come back. Mm. So, if they can't get it to man their own stations, guess who gets called? We do. That's why we have such a large volume of mutual aid calls. They're not even getting their people back. Why? There's a lot of various reasons. Some of them are like, I go in and do my fireman job, my 12-hour shift, my 24-hour shift, and that's it. Bye-bye, see you later, I'm gone. Mm-hmm. I had a mentality when I used to do this stuff is when it went off for somebody to come back, I went back because there's guys that need help. You should be able to have enough loyalty and dedication to your profession to come back and help the guys that are going through this stuff. It's not like that. Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to expound anything here, but it's all over the place. That, you know, it's the millennials or whatever we want to call them. I mean, we're all above that, you know, and I'm sure we see it with our kids and whatnot, but it's a definite change from what I've seen since I've been here.
Yes, Denise. Mark, when we were talking in the CFP program, and we had discussed the radios, and we said that we thought it was a good idea to go through your operational budget. Did that change? Because I don't see it in here.
The radios that we're going to put
remember, you were looking at doing replacements for years, multiple years on capital improvement, and we said maybe you should be putting it in your operational budget and do 5 or 6 a year and not have it be CIP. But I don't see it.
No, I did not put it in.
Did that change? Or is it your presentation? You doing this, it didn't get cut somewhere else?
No.
Right?
Nope.
Okay.
Nope, I just did not add it in here. Because there's some other priorities right now.
Okay.
Charlie? Well, I got a simple question. Do you have any warrant articles for this year you're planning?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
So at the end of Q3, you had about $17,000 in unexpended funds. Can we use any of that?
No.
So why not?
Because it is not. It may be unexpended right now, but it's earmarked for things that we need to use.
Okay. So you expect to spend $6,000 on protective clothing before the end of the year?
Yes, I already.
don't have an up-to-date number. That's why I asked the budget committee to bring forward the up-to-date numbers, so we know what's been expended.
The quarterly numbers are the most up-to-date numbers that the select board uses when we do our budget, so you have the numbers that we use.
So this says there's $17,000 in unexpended funds. So 6,000.
Throughout the fire department?
I'll go through it. 6,000 in protective clothing, $3,000 for a hose, $1,000 for the Scott air packs, $2,200 for the scuba packs, and $5,700 in equipment.
So those are the budgets that we put together at the beginning of the year. And we don't necessarily end up spending things quite in those same lines. And the board has had extensive conversations with Chief Rutherford about equipping the new fire engine, equipping the new command vehicle. And so some of this unexpended balance that we've talked about is going to do that very thing. So it will be expended for those purposes.
Within the next 30 days?
Yeah.
So vehicle repairs,
They're not in those lines. They're within the fire department, but they're not necessarily in those lines. We have the right, we can spend the money where we need to spend it, right?
Right.
You don't have to spend it in those lines.
Okay. So can you tell me what their budget is expended to date?
No, I'm afraid I can't.
It's really hard for us to plan when we have no data to look at for the year.
We have quarter three data.
That's
what the
board
uses.
That's what I'm looking at. It says there's $17,000 here.
Right. And so if I did an expenditure report right this very minute, you still wouldn't see. You'd still see about that much because these are the conversations that we've been having recently. So this is why we have this meeting. We talk about this. We let you know those kinds of things. They're not going to show up on an expenditure report necessarily.
I guess I would argue that. When the town gives each entity a budget, that's their budget to do. And to sit back now at this point and say, well, how come you didn't spend this, or why didn't you? This conversation I think we should have at the end of the budget year when we can look at their budget and say, okay, well, you didn't spend $17,000 last year. What happened? That's the time, I think, for this type of discussion, because we've given them, in effect, the money. We said, here's your budget, which they submitted to us. We looked at it, we said, this, whatever, and okay, here's your budget. To come now and say, well, you have $17,000, why didn't you do anything with it? I think it's not right, because we should wait until the budget year has ended, because that's what we gave them the money for, was to spend for the year. And if at the end of the year, if they've overspent, then that's a problem. If they've underspent, then maybe we need to adjust their budget. So that's...
Michelle, I need to respond to that. We won't know those final figures till what? March, maybe?
Phil?
Or April, when the audit
is done?
Well,
we'll have unaudited year-end expenditures for the February budget hearing.
Right.
So, and when the board presents to this group in December, I don't know exactly when that is, we will have expenditures through 11:30 for all.
11:30.
Yes.
Not 12:31.
Well, we're meeting in
December.
Yeah. So we're always almost a quarter behind in terms of real life data.
Yes.
But so by then we will have made a decision about what the budget will be, and we can't really argue the issue of why didn't you spend this or why did you spend that. It's over. It's done.
Jimmy?
If I may, using the example of the school, we have no data when we set the next year's school budget. We've gone through one quarter or two quarters of the school budget, and there's nothing to do with it. What the school does when it sets the next year's school budget, it looks back 5 years, and it says, so what was the trend? Are we going up on utilities? Are we going down on utilities? Well, we're going down because they're being incredibly well managed now. So we can put a savings in our utility line. We don't say how much have we spent this year exactly right up till this point, because it doesn't make any, because that's, we're planning a budget for 18 months from the time we start building it. So budgeting isn't an exact process where one's going to end and you're going to know everything, and put everything into it based on just 1 year anyway, in most cases. You're going to look over a number of years to budget properly. So to say that you need expenditures to date is, it's very difficult to do, and I don't think it's helpful.
I think having expenditure data is very helpful. I mean, I can't speak to the school, so it's very helpful. But, you know, you can tell, I mean, the board uses quarter three expenditures in order to work on its, do its budget prep work, which has been sufficient. But we're happy to tell you, you know, if you see things like $17,000 that look like they're going to be unexpended in the fire department budget, that we've had conversations, and we've just told you some of the conversations that we've had. Last year, when we were when we had some issues somewhere else, I don't even know where, you know, we had gone to the fire department and other departments early in the season. We sucked some money out of the fire department budget. That's our plan. What you're looking at, well, not the one in the book, we have the planned budget, and that's what we work from. But as you know, even from quarter three, we'll make revisions to the budget as we go along when circumstances dictate. You know, something happened that we weren't anticipating, and so we move some things around. So we're happy to try to explain and help, but you know, we're working from quarter three expenditures just as well.
I feel confident, or it's okay to me to ask the question, and then, Chief, are you going to spend this money? Well, yes, I am. Okay. Another place I worked in the past, we would hold off until late in the budget year before we spent any money, because you always wait for the disaster to come. And that hurts you in a couple of ways, because at the end of the year, somebody said, well, you haven't spent this money, you know, you don't need it. Well, yeah, we do, but we're trying to be responsible managers of the money and not spend it, you know, in the event we have some major disaster. So it's sort of a two-edged sword. But I, for me anyway, knowing, you know, asking the question, Chief, are you going to spend the money? Yes, we are, or we've already spent it. I think that suffices for me, rather than seeing that it's been expended and, you know, that works for me.
Oh, so I guess the way I went through school and grew up as a child was, when you had a budget, you lived within your budget. And so it concerns me that I hear, okay, we didn't spend it on that, we're going to spend it on something else. That concerns me as one problem. The second part is, you know, just as an analogy, if you give your son, your college student, $1,000, here's your spending money for a quarter, and he comes back to you and says, Daddy, I need $1,300 next quarter. And you say, why? Well, I spent it, you know, I didn't spend it on what you thought it was going to spend. Now I decided to buy some clothes, but I need more money. That's not the way budgeting is supposed to work. And do you teach your children, not saying you guys are kids, but do you teach your children that? Or do you teach them to allocate the money towards what you expect them to allocate and try to live with that?
Go ahead, Bill.
But I guess I look at it in the same, using that analogy, if my son says, Dad, I had to spend it on this because, so in effect, he is moving money from one part of the budget to another. As long as the reason is good, reasonable, okay. But if it's, you know, Dad, I spent, you know, $1,000, we had a huge party and it was great, it's not acceptable.
Well, see, that's the problem, is we don't really know that until it's already gone. So how do we
know?
But
we ask the questions.
Not a big party.
And the chief is telling us what he's using it for.
Well, see, and that's what I'm saying, is we don't have visibility into where that $17,000 is going this year.
Well, you will,
but
it's not gone.
But it'll be gone. It'll be passed.
Well, what is that, how does that affect
the decision on the budget?
We can't have the back and forth like this.
I'm just saying we will have made a decision on the budget by the time we figure out where the money went.
But hang on 1 second, Andy. I think, you know, Bill made a good point that there's a budget that's presented, that's accepted, that's been voted in, and to try to micromanage the budget that's already been accepted, mm-hmm. I don't think is appropriate. It's seeing, okay, looking at what happened, whether it was last year that we've asked for
multiple years, which has been supplied by the select board, to be able to see, you know, what the trends are. And I really, for the sake of the other two parties waiting here too, I'd like to finish this discussion, if we possibly can, by 7:30, so that they have a chance to go take their turns as well. Nancy.
Yeah, case in point, if you look back at the last three, I don't know how many years, they always wait until the end of the year to do their hose budget. That's when they come in. They'll come in December because they know they've got the money to use for the hoses, as I've seen in all of the meetings that I've gone to. So that's where some of that goes, Kim, is because they know they're going to spend it, but they wait until the end of the year to be sure they're going to have it and don't need it somewhere else to spend it on. Now, done with that. Your government buildings, you put this in, and this is you didn't put any money in that you wanted to increase it, but you're saying a lot of things that are wrong with the buildings right now. Was there a reason why you didn't put in $1,300 to fix your leaking toilet?
That was $7,500. I hope to accomplish the things that we need to get to that point. I didn't see the need for an increase.
Okay.
Back to you a little bit, Kim, on some of the stuff you're asking about, some specifics. There's got to be flexibility within the budget. I mean, if we can't only spend it on what this list is, then we might as well just eliminate half. There has to be that flexibility. Like vehicle repairs. How do I know that I'm not going to have to pay $3,000 because we blew out an engine or something like that, you know, with a very hot number? But there's certain things that we just cannot anticipate on that spending. You ask why there's $17,000 in there? I've held back on spending for the reasons because we knew we were having this new equipment arrive. There was not money built into the warrant articles for outfitting the fire trucks. Every penny was spent to get the truck here. The truck needs a radio. The radio is $5,037. That's coming out of this budget. I'm going to find a place for it. The command car sitting outside. There's $6,200 left from the warrant article. It's going to be close to $9,000 to get radios, lights, and striping and stuff on the vehicle. It's coming out of this budget. I'm finding a place for it. There's a few items on the fire truck which we've added and made some changes. It's $3,500. It's coming out of this budget. So just because right now we're not right at the 17, where is it all going? It's all been discussed and appropriated. I've talked to the select board. They know anytime you come to a meeting in here for a select board thing, any one of the Monday nights, I'm very transparent. I put out everything that we're going to be doing with, where we're going, why it's budgeted, what the timeline is, and it's out there. It's not like there's anything that's not being placed right out in the wide open.
Charlie?
I think the reason, on your command vehicle, I think the reason why that went over is because you're not getting last year's, you're getting next year's, which cost you more money because the select board didn't give you the okay early enough. Is that right?
That's part of the reason why. So the price went up by a couple of
and that's the reason why command vehicle is more expensive. And he put the warrant.
Okay, last one.
Yeah. So just three quick things. One is, I think having to outfit all these things should have been considered as part of the cost. So that wasn't good planning.
No, that's wrong. That's a period of no. Because if I had done something like that, we would never got a warrant on it.
Well,
I cannot plan what a radio is going to cost me from 1 year to the next year. We just sat down and had a quote from them in August, and we had to wait because the car was delayed in getting here. Just a matter of 2 months from when one expired to the next, they went up by almost $300.
Sorry, but I get it. I do understand. It's still part of the planning process. Second is we need to figure out a way to keep these budgets from going up 3%, 5%, 10% every year, and learn to work within our budgets. And then the last thing is, in terms of us micromanaging the budget, I've talked to several budget committee chairs in the area. We are probably by far one of the most passive budget committees in the area.
Judy, did you ask anything? Did you?
No, I just wanted to say that I feel that we have an incredible fire department for the money, and the reason we plan a budget is so that we can see what the increases are going to be. Not that we want to keep them exactly what they were 10 years ago or 1 year ago. It is to see what we need to do for the next year. So most things are going up. And especially salaries, and it looks like we're gonna have some things to do there, but that's the whole point of budgeting, is to budget for that year, not to try to keep it at some arbitrary figure from the past. Thank you.
Okay, Chief, you're free.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
That's the one that they're proposing for the initiative, isn't it?
That's really what we're doing, and I think you're going to find it's a very small increase overall. We have had some changes, as you probably know. We don't own our building, we pay rent. Rent is similar to what it was last year, but it's going up a little bit, incrementally over the years as we have in our lease. So those are the big things. So if you have any questions, I hope I can answer them.
Nice. Well, it says increased to $1,575 for the rent. What was it previously?
Last year?
It was $1,500.
It was $1,500.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Thank you.
Ken?
Can you tell me what the salaries were last year?
The salaries last year were around $45,000.
No, individual, like, do you have it, the director, the assistant, the library?
I don't have that figure right now, but overall it was $45,000.
I did.
You have last year's. I figured you would have.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, this is. Can I?
Yeah. Okay.
Sure. So you'll see that they're doing something a little different when the police come up to present their budget. And so, in order to provide at least the same level of information that the budgeting process did, and this actually provides a whole lot more, we have an earnings report. So of all of our employees, and so that includes, you know, the library, the volunteer firefighters on call, and I'm not going to say anything in here. So if you'd be able to see it right there. And just to orient you, if they're by department, and you can see their current rate, and whether that's an hourly rate or an annual rate. And we've provided you both their entire 2016 earnings, if they were here then, and their 2017 earnings to date.
Great.
And so what we'll do, if I may add another thing, so what we'll do for the annual report is at that point, we won't do the prior year. We will just have the 2017 rate and the 2017 earnings through the calendar year. So it'll be a full year's worth. Right now, we just have it through November 17th.
Okay.
Pardon?
Is there any chance we can get this electronically as a spreadsheet?
Just remind me.
Can we get this as a spreadsheet? Okay. I did, I reminded you.
Okay, will do.
No, I mean, do you want me to email you, do you want me to?
Well, it's probably best.
A basket of fruit with a card on it?
So if I read this right, based on what Susan gave me, the director's increase is $2,800, $2,800.
$11,000.
Is that correct?
I'm sorry.
Based on, from last year to this year, the increase that's being requested is $2,800, $2,800.
Yeah.
Have the hours changed, or what is the change there?
I mean, that's more a reflection of increase in, I mean, competitive salary. I mean, I make, as a director, half of what most directors make.
Basically, when we looked at what directors in other libraries are making, I will tell you that part-time, well, they don't have any part-time directors, but I can tell you, quite frankly, our director has been pretty meagerly paid in comparison to what most of the other libraries are, of similar size. So what we're trying to do is, as we feel that we have a director that's willing to work on these part-time hours and to do these things, we'd really like to retain her. We don't need to lose her and end up paying more to get a director to do the same thing. She's been pretty forward-looking, been very careful with our budget, as you can notice. And if there's something that we haven't needed in the last couple of years, you probably noticed that actually her duties have changed, because we did have a children's librarian a couple of years ago. And what has happened is, rather than having a children's librarian retained, Sarah, our director, has actually taken over those functions of the children's librarian at this time. So she's doing that as well. So I think that we should be looking at her as doing a very good job, and we'd like to draw attention to her. In the meantime, the other employees were giving them slight rises in their hourly pay to try to, again, retain them. When we have somebody that's really good, for instance, one of the employees who's been working on the children's, reading thing with the toddlers. They have a nice story time. And the children in the story time have been increasing to the point where she's getting at least 20 kids cycling through, which is a lot larger than we have in the past. So when we have somebody like that, we're finding a gem, and we want to extend our appreciation. But all of our people are like that, but that's just examples, and I think we have to do all we can. We don't want to lose any of them, because basically we don't have a lot of, to keep our library the hours we have, it would be pretty hard to do it if we had to do it any other way than the way we're doing it now. And I think it's really a valuable asset to our community.
Lauren, how many hours are you open?
42 hours a week, I believe, which is a pretty, this is actually more hours than most libraries around here are open. But it's really, we're trying to do that because our community uses the library during those hours. I mean, I don't think there's any time you can go in there. There's, occasional slow time that there's not a lot of people, but there's any time you walk in there, in the day, we're open 9 to 7 on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And then on Thursday, 9 to 5. Sunday 1 to 4, and it gives us a good mix of people that come in through the day and in the evening. Of course, as you probably all know, we also have we're open for community hours for people to come in and use the community room.
And just a follow up on that. So, how many hours do you work as a director?
I work 24 hours a week.
So if you, when you looked at salaries around the area, were those full-time, those people are all considered 40-hour employees?
Or? Yeah.
Okay. So your salary is reflecting half of what?
And
yes,
even then,
a little more than half of what?
Yes.
Okay.
But you should also note, like, there's no employee overlap. We only have one employee working at any one time. So, and I work probably 10, at least 10 more hours than the next person down.
I was trying to make a comparison that, say, your local librarians that work full-time make $60,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
You're working half of that, a little over half of that. So where did your salary fall in there? That's what I was leaning towards, not, which it looks like to me is probably pretty close to what, if you took their salary and cut it in half, you would be pretty close to that. That's not a bad thing. I'm just trying to make a comparison.
I would say she's still a little bit under what most everybody else is around here, but that's okay. I mean, as long as she's willing to stay with us under the circumstances.
Kevin?
What towns did you come on do salary comparison with?
Most of the libraries around. We looked at all the libraries around from, you know, and also
like
looked at libraries in
size.
Small ones up north and stuff.
Like Lee,
Bartlett,
Jackson, a lot of the small libraries, and then a lot of the small, and then some of the libraries around here. For instance, some of the larger libraries around here, people that aren't even directors are making $70,000. So, you know, we just can't even look at that. I mean, we looked at it, but said, well, that's not us.
So you had six people on staff last year. You have four now. Is that correct?
No, we had there's four this year. No, there's four last year too. It hasn't changed.
Is it because these are subs? This four, two, three, four, six people.
The trustee's secretary is just for trustee meetings, and the subs are if you know people take vacation.
But I mean the five other
so there's not a children's librarian. There's just the director, the library assistant, and two assistant librarians.
Go ahead, Suzanne.
What they're seeing is the set of both 2016 and 2017 employees.
Oh, okay.
That's
zero.
Are you manning the same number of hours?
Am I? Yeah.
No, but as a group.
Oh.
Like it says 78 hours. It looks like it adds up to 78 hours. No, I'm sorry. It's doing that per hour, rather. How many hours, in other words, how many hours are you paying for?
40 altogether.
Total
of
40.
42. Yeah.
And what did you do last year? Was it the same?
It was the same. Our hours haven't changed.
Any other questions for the library?
One question, showing my ignorance, but who's getting the museum passes? What's that $900 appropriation due to?
Actually, that is provided to us by the Friends, by the Friends of the Library. So when you're looking at the bottom, we included in our budget, but then if you look at the stuff that we're getting from the Friends, it shows that we have some money that is a wash. In other words, if, for instance, if they stop giving us museum passes, we wouldn't have any money because we wouldn't have them, although they're pretty popular.
Who do you give those to then?
Every person who comes to our library is allowed to use those museum passes, so if you have a library card, use it.
Oh, yeah.
It's a very, very good deal, and people need to know it's a wonderful deal. Not
everybody. I wasn't aware. Yeah, it sounds like a good
deal. We have some great museums that you can utilize with your pass. So.
Well, it's not just one museum.
Right, different museums all around. Most of them are in the five. Yeah. So it's pretty nice. And it offers, some of them are free, and some of them are, you know, like you have a reduced rate. But it's a very good deal.
Charlie, did you?
I got a simple question. What's the library card cost?
Our library card is free for for everybody, because that's the way the law sets it up. All our public libraries have a free library card for all residents. If you are not a resident of this town, but because we have a reciprocal deal with South Berwick, South Berwick is also free. And I think Elliott is also free, because we had a deal with that. But if people from out of town would like to join, they would have a $20 fee. So if it's a different town, and we do have people that do join from out of town, and they're happy to pay the $20 fee.
Just the formatting, could we see this in the same format where we see past years all together, or did I missing something here? It just, you know, this shows what budget is, but it's not showing what we had, it's not showing the history. And I'd like to see, you know, for the future,
okay,
just what, you know, what the past two, three, four, however many years
so
we can go back.
Trends.
So we can see trends and
right.
What's going on. So
exactly.
I just
we're happy to do that.
Offer that. And honestly, if we could standardize that throughout the whole town so that we have the same documents,
yes,
you know, with the same format for everybody, it would be I would find that much easier. So thank you.
He's so mad at you, I still know.
And that may be to the template you have set up already.
Right? I would appreciate that as well. So it's just a question of herding the cats,
yeah,
and you know, but it is a noble goal, and I support it 100%.
I think probably a spreadsheet or something, sending, you know, saying this is the format.
Right.
But just I have a real question. So your bottom line appropriation then looks like it's only increasing by $1,624 and change. If the bottom line appropriation that you're asking for is really $74,997, so this revenue is not considering this revenue on the bottom.
No. It's not considering that revenue on the bottom. No.
So you're only increasing $1,600, but I guess I'm trying to figure out if you're asking for almost $3,000 more, but the budget's only going up $1,600.
Right, we're saving in other places, as you can, for instance. One of the places we've saved is operating costs. They have dropped somewhat this year. We've had programs and services have dropped a little bit, and we're just trying to be careful about how we do stuff. But overall, it's doing well.
So then, I just need to make sure compilation of the entire budget. So that's the figure is the that's the gross.
It is the gross.
Okay, then that's how I entered it.
Because we're supposed to be giving you the gross.
Yes.
And as I say, and then it's possible that we can be offset because Frank would be giving us certain things.
Ken, so last year, I brought this up, and I'll bring it up again this year. How do you determine the value of your employees? Do you do performance reviews?
Yes, we have performance reviews twice a year.
Okay. So that's the best answer I've heard all day. And so that's another thing we really should consider standardizing across all departments is a process for reviewing performance instead of just blindly giving out increases without really evaluating how people are performing.
Any other questions for the library?
We have cover sheets as well.
Thank you.
I'm just going to make one comment that I'm going to defer to Lieutenant. You know, for some time now, you've heard members of the community and members of this board say that rather than do across-the-board increases, do a merit-based system. Well, that's what our budget does this year. But I want the board here also to know, the committee here to know that we've been doing evaluation of the police department yearly since I've been the police chief. And we actually did it before I took over. So we have been doing that, and we will continue to do that. So.
Can you let him start his presentation, Brian, and then you
well,
can
no,
ask
this is
questions?
A very simple question. I swear to God, it will take 10 seconds.
Has nothing to do with the budget either.
10 seconds.
I know where
go
it's 10
ahead.
Seconds.
Go ahead.
Your final word. Where do we put the dump stickers?
No. It's not my final word. It's the town clerk's final word. And I've given her my opinion.
And your opinion is?
My opinion was back window, top left. It's my understanding that they want to do it front window, top right. Or passenger, I'll say, passenger side, top right. Okay.
Thank you.
So.
That's it. See?
Okay. We don't have many changes this year. We're trying to keep in mind, just like everyone else, about the budgets and trying to keep them down.
No. This is inaccurate. It's wrong.
Why?
Let him finish. Let him open and do his presentation, and then
we
can ask him questions, okay?
All right. The changes that you will see is the first very line of the chief. He's looking for a $1,523 increase in his budget line for 2018. The full time, you see that change? That would be for a slight increase in my line item from 2017 that was discussed with the board and the chief after the budget went through, as well as the pay raises. Again, that would be merit based on the evaluations. So that change would be $8,317. Under contracted services, you'll see we're looking to add another $10,000. That will not affect the tax base at all. That's all money that is recouped. That's details basically. So that is all money that we are paid to work those details, whether it's Eversource or the tree cutting or road construction. They bring all that money back. So the town gets all that back. And I believe we're somewhere in the 50,000s for this year. Is that correct?
Actually, we've generated $73,000 in income for the town so far this year.
So
I anticipate another $6,500 between now and the end of the year.
So that's
my
cash.
73,000.
We've been very lucky the last few years to be able to work outside of Reynoldsburg. Lee has been a hotbed, Barrington, Durham this year. They had a ton of work going on, and they were constantly looking for two officers 5 days a week at a minimum, sometimes three. Unfortunately, we're just so tiny we can't give three, four guys a whack.
The contracted services comes out of that 72,000, but having said that, I think we've only expended at this point somewhere around 39,000 to 40,000 out of that line item. So Tom's making a little cake here on the side.
Mm-hmm. So that is why we are looking
it's
for
revenue to offset. Revenue to offset direct and indirect expenditures.
Not cake, not coffee.
Yeah, not profit.
That is why we're looking to increase that, though, because obviously each year, and it doesn't seem like the work's going away in these towns.
Mm-hmm.
So if we can continue to work them, it gives the guys a chance to make extra money as well. So that gives them a little incentive to work, knowing that they're going to make a detail rate instead of their normal pay. Payroll taxes and retirement, those are set by the town. We have nothing to do with those, but you can see that those would be the changes. Set by the state, and so it looks like those changes, the current numbers would be 5,815 and 8,418. Then everything else you'd see all the way to the last line, hazardous cleaning. That is something new that we're looking to add this year. And instead of having all the officers' uniforms cleaned on a regular basis, which was going to be somewhere around $7,000 to $10,000, we'd rather see that put into the raises. So we just put $500 to open that line for hazardous cleaning. There's a lot more things these guys are walking into these days. Car fentanyl, heroin, bed bugs, things that, you can get dog crap on your uniform, yes. So instead of having to take these home to their children and their wives and their families and have to put the stuff in their own washing machines, this gives us a line item where they can have the uniform cleaned by a professional that can get that stuff out of it and that we won't have to bring that stuff home. So we figured it would be more appropriate to start this year with a $500 line item for instances like that instead of just always having the uniforms cleaned just because they're dirty from everyday wear.
So are the officers cleaning their own uniforms?
Correct. Okay. We have for since I've been here. And if you want them professionally cleaned, it's always out of our own pocket.
But can I just clarify, did you just say that the cleaning was running, I thought you just said the cleaning was running X number of dollars, and now you're going to put that into another line?
Well, we checked into what it would be.
Okay, what it would be.
Something like the highway department. They're having their uniforms cleaned every week. They just throw them in a bucket. Someone comes and picks them up, brings them back the next week. Okay. We checked into something like that and found that would be somewhere between $7,000 and $10,000 for all of our guys. So instead of doing that, we are suggesting for these instances where they get exposed to something, blood even, you know, throw up, something like that, that we have this line item where now they don't have to take this uniform home, put it in their own washing machine with whatever.
Right. Okay.
Is that enough? I mean, that's $100 probably each patrolman.
Not even.
Is that enough? Because I know having your laundry done at like a Clary Cleaners or something like that is not cheap.
Right.
I mean, want to make sure you think you have enough for that, because I'm sure you get exposed often.
It's not too often, luckily, but you know, you never know when that's going to change.
Right.
You know, any day, it's with the heroin and the car fentanyl, and it's you almost have to put a hazmat suit on to search people now. It's gotten to that point.
Just as a follow-up, and then Nancy, as a follow-up to Denise, though, do you have any idea how many times your folks have been exposed to something that now they would say, you know what, I don't want to take this home?
I would say at least 15 to 20 times a year. Me personally, this year, there's been several times where I've had to leave shift, go home, shower, and change because I was exposed to something that got on my head from a call. And at least 5 to 10, just me personally.
So to, you know, mirror Denise's question, if you say, let's just say 20 times, is that enough? Is that 500, do you think that's enough?
I guess it depends what the exposure is. You know, fortunately, we haven't had a car fentanyl problem here yet. It's probably going to happen, but it's happening increasingly everywhere. You know, our biggest issue right now is blood, mud, and sometimes bed bugs or insects. And you know, if we have a situation where an officer gets that, not only is he contaminated, he's also contaminated the cruiser. Mm-hmm. If they go home, now they've contaminated their house. So the plan is to at least start somewhere with some figure, and whether you use the money to clean a uniform or we hire some professionally to clean out a car, because a car has been exposed to urine, throw up, whatever the case might be, or blood. That at least gives us a start. And we can evaluate it as we go along in this process. But rather than take the money from someplace else, because the budget, the operations part of the budget is very tight, we decided that we had to throw something in there. And I know at least one other select board member had suggested, let's just have the town pay for the cleaning of all the uniforms. Well, we found out it was going to be, you know, $7,000 to $10,000 to do that for the year. I said no. We went to a less expensive uniform. Prior, our uniform used to be dry cleaned, but the staff had to do that themselves. So we saved money for the staff by going for a wash and wear uniform, and by going to this wash and wear uniform, it's also cheaper to purchase from the manufacturer. So we save money for the town. We save money for the staff and cleaning. But now that we're getting into situations where we're increasing the possibility of getting exposed to something, it's time that we as a department set something up for the staff so that if they do get exposed, they're not going to contaminate the car, to go home and change, to come back here. They're not going to bring whatever they get on the meter to their home. We should stop it here and not let it go anyplace else.
Nancy,
yeah. When you're talking the $5,000 to $10,000, is that meaning that you would have more uniforms and with the cleaning service? Is that the
no? That's with the with the current allotment that our staff has now.
Is that, I'm sorry, what is that?
Three for full-time, three full sets, pants and shirts for full-time and two for part-time.
Well, I was just going to say that, you know, from a budget preparation, budgetary analysis point of view, I mean, now we've got that purpose in there, the uniform for the police, as the chief said, we'll be watching this. And so if it looks to be insufficient, you know, we'll look for other places in the budget, not necessarily the police budget, but other places in our budget to supplement that so that, you know, as, so that next year we're better prepared to see whether we were, it was a decent estimate or not. But that's one of the reasons why, you know, we move budgets and dollars around as we govern throughout the years, because you don't know precisely how things are going to work out.
Any other questions, Kevin?
Well, Bob, I have a hard time resolving your bottom line numbers against the appropriation. The appropriation for the police department for 2017 is $619,722. But this is
538,138. I think that the select board took some items out of our budget and added to the executive portion of the budget, so
yes.
You can address that with them.
Can I address that? That's a good point. So we were advised at some point during the year that for a small municipality like ours and small departments to put items like health insurance in the departments themselves, it would allow public to know whether somebody was taking a single, a married, you know, two person or a family. And, you know, oh, last year they were a two-person, now they're single, what's going on? So for purposes of privacy, we've taken the insurance costs, the health insurance, life insurance, and put it all under, it's not quite executive, but it's under the insurance or personnel administration. So you'll see that when we do the, when you see the full budget.
Okay, so I can't really discern what increase you have for the bottom line this year. That's all. I'm sorry.
Well, they would be the chief raise, the full-time raises. The 10,000 is a big one, but remember that offsets because it doesn't come on the tax base, but it's added in there. Then you have the payroll taxes and the retirement.
Okay, so that's
plus the 500.
And that's, so that would be whatever the 619,000 was last year. It would be $34,000 on top of that.
Correct, 34,573.
I was just going to say that, yes, because I had that number here. It's about a 6.6% increase. A lot of that coming, as the lieutenant just said, from the detail, the increase in the detail work.
And part of the increase of the payroll tax and retirement also was part of the contracted services. So the town through a tax dollar that you're collecting will not actually be all of the 58.15 increase or the 84.18 increase. Some of that's going to be supplemented by the rental is generated by the details.
And from a retirement system, the biennial started in last July, and so the rate increase for the New Hampshire retirement system last year was just for 6 months. So we had the first part of the year and then the increase for the latter part of the year. This year, the increase is there for the full 12 months. So that's just the way it is.
Okay, I got to go on to our full-time salaries. Okay, 9 days after the last town meeting, Lieutenant got a $2,000 raise. I'm not criticizing that. I would just ask why. Is there a reason? I'm sure he deserves it, but there must have been a reason what brought it up.
Well, you know, I'm in the process of setting the department up, so when I finally do retire in a couple of years, that we're going to have a smooth transition. And right now, I think the general consensus is, at least with the select board anyway, is that we promote from within. You know, so we give the staff that we have here some reason to stay here and have some upward mobility. And, you know, when we look at the job that the lieutenant was doing compared to what his job functions are being performed by other departments, we felt that there should be some adjustment there. And the big thing was prosecution. Almost every other city and town in this county pays a lawyer, a huge fee to prosecute for the department. We always prosecute our own cases at the district court level court, at the district court level, I should say. Except for now, the county attorney does the domestics, but you know, for many years, I did the prosecuting here, and then the lieutenant came on board, he's done the prosecuting here. And that's a huge chunk of time, and that's a very valuable asset to have someone that can do the court process, have a good relationship with the attorneys, have a good relationship with the court system and the judges, so that we can have some successful resolutions to, you know, almost 99.9% of our cases. And my concern was that, you know, I didn't want the lieutenant to start looking elsewhere. So that's why.
Thank you. That's the answer I wanted. Sure. Now, I got to follow up on that on the salary. So basically, you're looking at 3% because I think the half percent is because of the last year's.
Correct.
Okay. Now, following up on that, do you have somebody retiring this year?
We have someone that's eligible to retire in April.
Yeah, in April.
And the belief is that he will retire when he gets a job sometime thereafter. He'll have his 20 years in,
yeah,
and he'll reach 45. So at some point in 2018, we'll be looking to hire somebody else.
So he hasn't really come up?
Possibly.
Yeah.
So.
I understand the need for retention. Perhaps you should consider employment contracts?
We do employment contracts. We have 3-year contracts.
Okay. So lieutenant has an employment contract?
I served mine about 14 years ago. I was done serving mine.
But after the initial 3-year contract, we do not have extended employee contracts.
I got to clarify that. Multi-year contracts, explain that a little further, because you can't have multi-year contracts in the town without legislative approval if there's compensation involved, there's money involved.
Well, we don't call it a contract, we call it an employee agreement, where the person that we hire agrees to work for the town of Rawlinson as a police officer for 3 years.
Yes.
During that time, if they leave the police department to obtain a police job elsewhere, they're required to pay the town of Rawlinson a certain fee back. And we've calculated what we pay for their training time, their salary at the academy, the amount that we spend to uniform them.
Okay, so it's indirect costs.
Correct.
So when I got here back in 2001, because I was already certified, I had a 2-year contract, which I was done serving in 2003, and have stayed since.
But to clarify, it's really not a contract, more so as an agreement.
It's just an employee agreement.
Yes.
It's a reimbursement agreement,
yes.
Really.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, my concern is, people that we put through the academy and leave.
Right.
Right. And they had that covered.
Right. Nancy, did you were trying to...
all right. I'm going to be the bearer. When you're saying full-time salaries, are we going to have a breakdown at any time as to what the salaries are? This one? This will be next year? This is what they're
listing next year? For the annual report that we publish in March, it will look like this report, but can I just look in this for a second? It will just be focused on 2017. And so we'll have the 2017 rate, the earnings type, and then the 2017 earnings through December 31st.
So in the 2018 budget is going to be lump summed, and we're not going to have a line by line as to salaries?
That's right. From a budgetary point of view, we have full-time salaries, part-time salaries. Not unlike what many other places do.
Wait, you mean in the, you're not going to do the usual budget where you do the chief, the lieutenant?
We have the chief, we have full-time salaries, we have part-time salaries.
No.
Just a little surplus of
breakdown.
You have it right here. It's right.
No, I know, but for 2018, I want to see that. Broken down by position.
Anybody else have to? Somebody, you had your hand up, Suzanne, but I don't know if it was clarifying something.
I don't remember.
Okay. Did anybody have any other questions?
I just made a comment on that. But, problem with announcing ahead of time what the pay rate is going to be publicly for an individual like that. So then everyone's going to know, well, this officer got 1%, this officer got 2%, you know what I mean? So that might work as a disadvantage to the staff. If somebody wants to ask for the information, say it's public information, so we have to provide it. Mm-hmm. My concern is throwing it out there, and all of a sudden, town meeting comes up in March, and the officer says, well, hey, I thought I did a great job, but I only got 1% pay raise this year. What's the deal?
I need to respond. I'm sure that when you sit down with someone and say, this is how much I'm recommending for your pay raise for 2018, you explain why it's that number, right?
Correct.
Okay. Most people sort of accept that as a reality, because you must talk about, this is where I see some deficiencies, this is where I see some strengths. But even greater concern to me is union leader versus New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority says you have to disclose it.
I just want to say that it is disclosed, as the chief said, but I think his point, and I didn't mean to cut you off, Bill, is that if you go to a merit increase versus the everybody gets the 2% or whatever, now you're publicly displaying exceptional behavior versus average behavior versus not so average behavior. And I could see clearly at a town meeting that could be not so good. I mean, but it is public knowledge if somebody were to ask for it.
Then I'll ask for it.
It's public information, which is why we're going to publish the earnings report.
Yes, but I want to see it for 2018.
I don't know what it's going to be for 2018.
What is the purpose?
Why? Full disclosure. It's transparency and openness, that famous thing.
We don't know what it's going to be because there's overtime. Not everybody serves the same overtime. So this is the earnings report that shows you what people earned during that
past
year.
When you put in your budget and you put in the prospective wages for full-time and part-time, it's got to be done by detail.
If I can just...
That's unfortunately the way the law works.
Jump in with, I don't know how, if you're going to
disagree,
a merit increase, how you're going to put that in as 3% across the board, because that's the maximum that you could give. Is that, and then people have a misconception that that's going to be part of their salary. I don't think
you can do that. That's
but that's what you're saying. You're saying if you want a merit increase, that has to be budgeted, and if the cap on that is 3%, that 3% would have to be in your budget.
It
is in the budget.
Right.
Open and transparent has some downsides to it. One of them is you get to see all the dirty underwear sometimes. But that's just the way life is.
But it is, it's public knowledge. I don't think
public information.
Public information that can be asked. Yes.
Right, my point was, if you want to know what each salary is, you can ask it. That's your right. It's right for anybody to ask for it. It doesn't have to be as part of the budget broken down. I disagree with you there. It's available.
Yeah, sure. And I will point out that the school does regular education salaries. There happens
per
to be...
Per person.
No,
that's an addendum to the budget. It is not part of the budget.
Correct, but you also put it in when you present the budget.
And also, that is... partially true, but
give us a listing.
Well, that's
exactly what's happening here. The listing will be.
But this is something we should probably talk about without these folks having to sit through it, because it's more of a procedural thing. I think it's not going to be. Well, it's not just their department, though. I mean, it would affect any department on how it's being positioned in the budget.
I agree. It becomes part of the formatting of the budget.
Right. Does anybody have any more questions for these folks? Yes, John.
Yes. I'm looking on the advertisement. You got 150 last year, and you got 150 this year. Is that going to be enough if you have to have another officer if he retires?
Yes and no. Personally, I'm hoping that one of our part-timers comes on full-time next year.
Hopefully,
if the opportunity happens. If it doesn't, it won't be enough,
no.
But I can certainly absorb another $75 to $100 from someplace else to cover it. Okay.
Okay.
So.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Want me to finish? Do I run down?
Yes.
Under animal control, you'll see a $9 increase in her line item. That's because she actually deserves more, but she's done a wonderful job. Lakeisha's been a great find for us. She loves animals. She wants to be around to help. She wants to come in and volunteer on her time off with anything. It doesn't even have to be with animals. She just likes being around the department, and that's great. She's willing to work with all the ACOs in Dover. She's always asking to go on ride-alongs with the Dover ACO, the Rochester ACO. She wants to go to schools. She wants to go to classes that she sees at UNH. She wants to learn. So we're just looking to get a $90 increase in her line, and that would jump the payroll expenses by $7. So under animal control, it would only be a $97 increase.
And that actually equals only an additional $6 per year.
Good job, so. And then under emergency management, there's no increase. And then under the CIP, we're looking to add $2,500 back into the cruiser due to the fact that cars go up in price every year, so it's the equipment. That's what you heard from the fire chief tonight. And that's our budget in a nutshell.
Talk about capital improvement for the year.
Capital improvement, yes. Well, obviously, you know, we'll be asking for a crew in 2018. And I'm really not sure about the police department at this point. I'm trying to push for it. Just to give you an update, the town has received 5 proposals for the station. I've gone through them all. I've listed the pros and cons, all of them. And select the board member Rollo should be having a meeting of the Space Needs Committee sometime in the very near future so that the committee can look at the proposals as well. And I'm hoping the plan is to make a recommendation to the select board to look at one or two of them, call the vendors in, have a public hearing, so the public can ask questions, you know, why you're building, what's it really gonna cost, and you know, what makes you so special and whatnot, and then go from there. If you read my notes in the CIP, at least when I last reviewed it, and I'm not sure if it's changed or not, but there was a $50,000 line item starting in 2018, going to whenever. My recommendation would be to, if we had the support for a new police department, use that $50,000 that's in the CIP as the bond payment for the building. In 1998, the town has set aside $50,000 as the bond payment for the renovation of this building here for 12, 13 years or something like that. We just have to find the interest, the money for the interest portion of that, someplace else in the budget. So,
So what about engineering costs and architectural design costs?
That's part of the design build process.
Okay.
That's all included in the price that
okay.
they've given us for a total package. What we need to consider and we're actually investigating right now are like utility costs, propane versus heating oil, electricity, and things like that. Security system, you know, doesn't come that won't come with the building package. A telephone system, how much will that add to the total package as well? So,
final follow up on that.
No.
Are we anticipating a warrant article on this year?
Well, I think that's really up to what happens at the public hearing and the general consensus of the town's folks at that hearing. You know. The selectmen feel that this is the time to do it.
So public hearing
so.
This year?
No, we have to start before that.
I'm sorry?
A public hearing?
Well, as part of this, there may be more than one public hearing. I'm anticipating that this will be of interest to many of us for different reasons. And so I'm anticipating there may be more than one public hearing. I don't know that. We haven't, you know, we have put out the RFPs. We've gotten some, there was a nice building. Somebody had a picture of the building. It was very nice. It's a lot of money, and so there's a lot more. It's not just the building costs. So we have to make sure that we have a full project plan before we go forward. So we need to know what it's going to cost logistically to move the police station. How do you, you know, dismantle it here and then reinstated over there. We need to know what not having the police station does for the maintenance and operating costs of this building. We need to know what the costs are to operate and maintain that building. So there are lots of things that, you know, there are lots of pieces of the puzzle that we are just really in the beginning stages of trying to collect, and I think we need to have a better grasp of all of those.
So not likely to be sure.
I'm only speaking for myself. That's and I know how this is near and dear to Chief Ducharme's heart, and I understand that. I hate, but you know, we just barely, you know, getting over the three long-term finance projects that we got authorized for this year. As far as, you know, we're closing on the culvert one. The culvert one is Friday, so you know, we're just now being able to understand what the cost of that is going to be going forward. So you know, we're just putting these figures together, and so you know, I'm what I'm hoping to do is just have some rough, you know, back of the envelope kinds of figures that will be part of the 10-year projection that says, okay, if we go forward here, you know, what's the difference between what we would be putting aside in the CIP and what we might be having to pay for the bond? So you can see its impact, you know, going forward. So
how long is the RFP valid for?
Well, we may, you know, we may have to do another RFP process. But we needed to have something. We needed to have a figure, right, so that we had some idea of what this, the scope of this, the financial scope of it. We had no clue. So it was an important exercise, and the Space Needs Committee did a great job, and I think we've got some really good and valid responses. They were in the, you know, 1.1 to, I'd say 1.1 to $1.3 million range, and that's just for pretty much the building and landscape, I guess some site work.
Site work, parking, exterior lights.
Yeah.
One quick question. Has any of the projects looked at the town hall above the police station? Have you done that in any of your committees?
No. I really don't want to speak for the committee. The chair should, but they decided that one standalone building, police department only at this point.
Denise? Yeah. When we were talking on CIP, you had talked about leasing two vehicles due to your high mileage.
Not this cycle, but in the next cycle.
Okay,
looking at leasing two vehicles.
Okay.
For a period of 3 years.
Right.
That will allow us to get rid of two of our high mileage vehicles, bring the mileage down, bring our vehicle maintenance costs down. Now, we won't add to the fleet. It will just allow us to get two newer vehicles sooner.
So the $25,000 that you're asking for is for just one new cruiser bought out, right?
Correct.
Okay, so that's the following is when you're going to try to do that. And your mileage is high now, though. Is that a risk? I mean, is that risky? Because you said your mileage is already...
No,
it's in a high
if we continue the way we're going now, in about 5 years we'll have three cruisers with well over 100,000 miles on them all the time.
Yeah.
So this will allow us to get the mileage. But we did this back in 2005. 1 year we leased two Chevys,
mm-hmm.
and that allowed us to bring the mileage back down again.
Mm-hmm.
And plus, this year we also started a program where we now have certain officers use certain vehicles. So now the mileage is being spread out over all of the vehicles as opposed to in the past. Everybody wanted to drive the newest car, you know, so.
And with this purchase, this will make all of your cruisers the Explorers or whatever, the SUVs, right? Or
correct.
Or do you have
yes.
all of them, or now?
No, we still have one sedan. We still have a Ford Taurus.
Okay,
so
being in this one, they'll all be the same.
Correct.
Thank you.
Did you have a hand up?
No, hold on a second.
Anybody else?
No. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions? You know where to reach me.
So we have a couple of things. Next on the agenda was Bill's suggestion, which I did forward to everybody, as far as the change to the guidelines. Did everybody get a chance to see that?
Yeah, okay.
put the agenda, yes. Did you get it in?
And you, did you get a copy of it?
Yes, he did.
Okay. He's just looking for it.
Bill, why don't you, you can talk about what you're thinking, I guess, to open the discussion.
Sure. My thought was, we need a better way to fill budget committee positions. The last time around, there was some concern, I guess, or whatever, and this, I think, provides us with a better procedure. And a better way to do it. So that's all I'm looking for. And I think, you know, I think it's valid to look at the number of votes that each candidate gets as being indicative of the will of the people to serve on the budget committee. So this codifies that, if you will, and says, you know, it doesn't matter what position, 1, 2, 3 years they're running for, whoever is the next highest vote getter is the one that should be at least offered the position. I've also written this so it says may. We don't have to. If there's some overriding reason that we say, well, you know, Mr. Jones was the next highest vote getter, but for some reason, whatever it is, I'm sorry?
He got arrested.
He got arrested or whatever. You know, we don't have to do it. It's not must. It's may. So it gives us some flexibility, but I feel it's important to, you know, to recognize, you know, I think the number of votes somebody gets is indicative of the will of the people to have that person on this committee. And so that's what I hope this, you know, when I wrote it, I hope it reflects that, so.
Just a procedural thing. Are you making that as a motion?
I opened it just for him to describe why we're even talking about it.
Okay.
But, you know, we could.
I think we're getting cart before horse now.
I'll make a motion that we accept the proposed amendment change to the bylaws.
Okay. And second?
I'll second.
Okay. So, discussion. Any discussion?
Oh, okay, now you can do your discussion.
What I said before.
Susan.
So, well clearly, I thought what happened in our last meeting was just completely unfair and not the will of the people. So this at least gets us closer. But, you know, there are times, so I'm glad to see the word may, because there are going to be times when we're electing three people and there are just three names. I mean, it's happened in the past and it could happen again. And so they really, you know, the next highest vote getter could be some write-in who got two votes.
Yep.
So that's, you know, just something to be cognizant of and to keep
right.
in mind.
If I may, that's why I worded it that way, to give us the flexibility to say, well, you know.
Yeah, Kim.
So I think to kind of respond to Suzanne's comment about it being unfair, I think just having no process, you know, doesn't make it fair or not fair. Because, and I made this point, I don't know how many of you read it, I got the next highest number of votes for the Library Trustee Committee. Nobody ever contacted. Nobody reached out to me, nothing. So they don't have a process either. There is no process. So I think having a process is really important, and I'm in favor of having a process. It's a guideline, however. Nobody is compelled to live by this law, just like this committee opted not to live by the guideline that recommends anything over $25,000 becomes a capital item. We don't honor that, so we're not compelled to honor this either. But having something in place is a good idea.
Since I'm a culprit that created some of this discussion, my concern here is guidelines and nature. Now, when I was selecting, we always said, well, what's the state policy and so forth on this? And I really didn't know in this particular case what it said, but I was told that the budget committee sets up its own guidelines. If that's true, then you're adopting something tonight, which I would then raise the issue, though, that after the election next spring, just as the Board of Selectmen used to, we set up guidelines among the three selectmen, and theoretically, the composition of the town committee, in this case, the budget committee, changes each year. It may be the same actors, but they've been re-voted in. So, or there may be different people. So, the issue is, you prove something here tonight, which you can, for the people who are sitting here now until next town meeting. But my issue is, how long is this valid for these guidelines? It seems to me you are not setting up guidelines for all future budget committee members. You're only setting them up for the setting board that we have now, and you should you may want to just ratify them again after a town meeting, but there should be every year, if this is the Bible we're following, re-verifying what it stands. So that's it. As long as I understand, or any other citizen should be able to understand, what the process that any board in this town is following with respect to guidelines or whatever other procedure, it should be clear and transparent to people around. And I don't think that we here tonight set the rules from here on forward, which just until after the next town meeting. If the next board wants to change them, they have the right to do that, or they may just pass a motion and say, well, we'll take them for another year the way they were. But there should be some verification that everyone clearly knows each year. And if I run for a committee, I just want to know what the rules are here, and whether you've taken all people running for the budget committee, or you're taking them. I was under the impression when I did it that it was for that 3 years. If I'd known it was going to be three people, I would not have signed up last year. I came in here a couple of days before, and there was nobody signed up for that vacant position. So I signed up, and then the last day, I guess, two more people came in and signed up for it. But when I signed up, I really did, because I said, I think there should be somebody running for all these. And there was somebody else running, so I signed up. And if I'd known another, I'm accused of being a conservative, but if I knew another person was running for it versus a so-called, quote, liberal or more liberal person, when there was three people running, I wouldn't have gotten involved in that at all. But I needed to know the rules for how you're going to make decisions. And not just with respect to this. It should be any board in town.
Suzanne, what's first, and Judy?
Well, just to answer a couple of things that you said, Ed, the RSAs with regard to the budget committee, an official budget committee such as this, good as this, say that the budget committee can appoint to fill a vacancy. It doesn't have to be what the guidelines, our current guidelines say. Secondly, I think we do that at our first meeting, is kind of reconfirm the guidelines. So the reason that we're changing them now is there could be another vacancy. And if there's another vacancy this year, I think we ought to consider the person who got 237 votes.
I just want to clarify what we're doing. We're really doing it for the rest of this year until next town meeting. And I would hope that whoever's on here next town meeting, after town meeting, would just, validate it. That,
sure.
Yeah, this is the rules. And
they are just guidelines.
That must mean it. You got them guidelines. And the budget committee will make the decision, though. The board of selectmen or some other board will not make the decision.
Not for vacancies on this committee, that's correct.
Okay, so that's the state statute.
That's state statute.
And so the only other point I was going to make, I think it should be re-ratified each year.
Absolutely.
That's what I was going to say as well. And I thought we kind of did that.
Yeah, I think so.
I think every year you have new players, or at least some new players, so it should be viewed to make sure we want to keep it, or they want to keep it, or they do want to do changes. I don't think that's a bad idea, Judy.
No, I was just also going to speak in support that it's a good idea. And I don't recall that it was done at the beginning of this term. I think it's a very good idea to re-ratify so that all the members know, have had a chance to read it and look at it. I think that's a great idea.
Yes?
I just have to say, I'm definitely part of the guideline. But I want to understand why we would not consider the candidates running for that seat instead of all of the candidates running for both seats.
I guess the biggest thing for me is that irregardless, they're only going to serve until the next election. So it's not 2 or 3 years. It's going to be for, you know, 9, 6, 3 months. There, for that reason, I think it's more valid to look at the total numbers rather than, you know, they were running for a 1 year or 2 year or whatever position. To me, it just makes more sense because, you know, it's irregardless of who it is, it's only going to be until the next election.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, that's
there's no such word as irregardless. Please stop using that word.
Well, there is, Bern.
No, it's regardless.
Irregardless. It means it doesn't matter. You may not like it, but irregardless, I'm going to use it.
All right, this is the Michelle recognizing me. So I think this is a very good point. Officially, there is no such thing as a one-year term. A one-year term gets created when someone serving a three-year term does not complete their term. There's no such thing as an official one-year term. So, I mean, I agree with Bill, in essence, then that you're being elected. You're elected. A one-year term is created because there's a vacancy. Then if you don't complete your 1 year term, you're only going to serve till the next election anyway. And I agree with what the way Bill's put that together, that that a budget committee member is a budget committee member in essence. So.
And 237 votes is greater than 148 votes.
Right, Joe.
Okay, I voted for Ed for one reason. He was a high vote getter in the 1 year term. Not 3 years, 1 year. And that was the reason why I voted him. If there's three positions, you're going to get more votes than a 1 year. You had three people, let me finish. You had three people running for 1 year who only could get one vote. You had six people running for 3 years who could get three separate votes. They could get two everywhere. So he was the high vote getter for what we were looking for.
Had there been someone running for that one-term position, it was entirely possible that that person got 237 votes. It is still represents the fact that 237 people voted for Miles England and 148 people voted for Ed. It makes no difference what that position is. You've got 237 votes that somebody voted for. Somebody could have voted for Allen. He could have had 237 votes, and it would have been less for the other two. It represents 237 votes that people made for one person, and to deny that just doesn't seem fair.
Follow up. That's just your opinion on a 3 year and a 1 year. We're voting on a 1 year because we were losing Allen, and that is why I voted for Ed. And he was a high vote getter in the 1 year.
Within the guidelines. The very last paragraph says, an amendment to these guidelines may be moved at any budget meeting, but not to be voted upon until the next regularly scheduled meeting. So if we're observing guidelines, that's the way life is. But the other one is, I'd like to call a question. I think, you know, it's starting to get a little warm.
Chippy.
I guess if what you're reading says that we need to wait a meeting in order to vote on it, is that what you were reading?
Well, that's what it says, but you know what? We might just ignore guidelines.
Well, it might. You know, I don't think that's really what we're trying to do here. Go ahead, Tom.
And I guess my thought was, and I agree with you, that we bring it up here, and, you know, not to rehash it, but had we, you know, had the foreknowledge that we were going to appoint somebody else to the budget committee, I would have liked to, you know, done it at the next meeting. Because then we all could have pondered it. And we could have thought about 1 year, 3 year, whatever that meant, and voted at the next election. So I'm fine. And I would actually appreciate if you all want to look at this and tweak it, and do we need to make changes to it, then do so, and we'll come back and we'll vote on it the next time. I that's perfectly acceptable to me. I think that's the way it should be.
Of the group, if they want to vote tonight.
No, it would have been nice to have it last time. That saying about process, which we did not.
Go ahead and answer.
Okay. I believe the meeting before this all took place, I brought it to the attention to the board that Alan no longer lived in town.
That was back in July.
Yes.
I'm not sure why we're discussing this again.
So, no, because he said that you had no foresight that there might be a vacancy. I brought it to the attention to the board that he had moved. That brought the following meeting.
No.
We can't make inferences based on pieces of information that we find out from a deed. We need to have, Alan was the chair of this committee, and he was the chair of this committee until he resigned from this committee. He, you know, we didn't know that. You did some research, and you made some assumptions based on the research that you did. You found it, I don't know, this bill of sale or whatever. But
it was sent to me.
It doesn't make any difference, does it?
No.
It was some inferences or deductions that you made and the committee made based on that piece of information. He was still the chair of this committee. He's, you know, he, it was news to many of us that night. Some of you knew,
mm-hmm.
talk about transparency, some of you knew, but the rest of us didn't know. So, and we did what we thought was the responsible thing and appointed Michelle to be our interim chair and find out from Alan what the story was.
I think, you know, we can repeat Alan, but I'd rather not. I think having this presented as Bill did and sitting on it for a meeting is a good thing and come back.
We're
the
back
next,
here next week, aren't we?
A week from tonight? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
regardless.
Be the first thing.
I don't remember. Yes.
That
so it's soon.
Well,
so next week, after the presentations, because I don't want to hold those folks up, then we could determine what, you know, what we want to do with this. But at least that would give everybody a week to, you know, look at it and decide what you want to do.
Yes. If and I'm in total agreement with that. But if this happens again, what happened the last meeting, it can't, if we're going to do this now and follow this rule, it follows everything that we do. No, it's not just a guideline.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
Oh, my God.
It has no force of law.
But oh, my God. All I'm saying is let's play the game fairly every time. And if you want a week to wait or the next meeting to wait, then every decision, when half the committee doesn't know what's going on until you bring it up, the other half did, that is not just a suggestion. That is unfair. And we should follow all of the rules.
Wait, are you saying easy there?
No, I won't go easy.
Are you saying follow all of the rules that are in the guidelines?
No, I'm saying if we make decisions and there's a motion and you guys want the next meeting to make that vote, every motion other than the budget's a process.
No, it's just that for this particular thing.
No, I'm saying everything. If there's a decision that needs to be made other than the acceptance to take a budget to a public hearing, if it has to do with personnel or anything that changes, when others know something that the other half of this committee doesn't know, it needs to wait the next meeting. It's only fair.
Well, there was a distinct staged appearance to what happened last time.
Absolutely.
I don't know how you can avoid that. A distinct staged appearance. Mr. Jansen doesn't come to budget committee meetings. He was here. A board member who doesn't normally come to a quarterly review was here in order to administer an oath. So there was this appearance of being staged. And I know that many of you, you know, get up here and talk about transparency, but it's only good, apparently, for some of us and not for all of us.
Right.
And so I would just like to encourage all of us to be as transparent as possible about what we do.
Right.
That's my hope.
I got to get a clarification. I'm hearing several different things. One is sort of, a dimming accusation, but I'll let that go. Are you saying that everything that's recommended by the budget committee has to wait until the next meeting?
Other than taking budgets to public hearings or accepting a budget. If we're putting a new member on or if we're doing a different process that we hadn't done before and nobody knew the recommendation was going to come forward, like this was sent out ahead of time so people knew what was going to happen tonight, I think we need to wait for the next meeting as well. What happened last meeting was irresponsible and uncalled for. And it needs to, we all have to play in the same rules. That's what I'm saying.
so.
I understand what you're saying, but I guess what I would suggest is that can we word that somehow and incorporate it into these guidelines? If we're going to use these guidelines, let's put something in there that says, in the event, you know, add language to what I put in there, mm-hmm. and I can wordsmith it a little more and say any elections shall be discussed at one meeting and voted upon at the next meeting. I mean, something along those lines, I'd be happy to do that. I'm just afraid, Denise, if we, you know, it might be too draconian to not be able to make a decision, you know, to push everything off to the next meeting. It might be too much. But I do understand what you're trying to get at, and I agree with you that we need the transparency that type of process would,
right.
Would get us to. So I guess I would suggest, if it's okay with the committee, is I'll add some language in there that says, you know, decisions made or whatever, I'll think of something. If anybody has language, feel free to send it my way, and we'll wordsmith it, we'll put it together, and I'll get it out to everybody, and, you know, we can vote on it.
Well, the guidelines can be gone over every time the election comes around the next year. That first committee meeting, have the guidelines gone over, have everybody agree for it for at least 1 year.
These are the rules we're going to play.
And go by that.
And we have those, and yeah, so we can add some language and tweak it, and that's what we go by.
Guidelines. But I, that being said, I really hope that if we're going to have guidelines, we use them, because it's a waste of time and energy if we're going to. If I recall, the guidelines came up, I don't know how many, 2 years ago? Was it 2 years ago? And there was a big push that we had to have the guidelines. And now I'm hearing the guidelines are just, we'll look at them if we want to. And that's, you know, I think we need, as a committee, if we're going to make guidelines, they should be at least utilized.
Respected.
And discussed. You know, if there's some reason we're variating with the word may, which is not a bad thing, it's been much easier to function than a shall, then it should be a discussion as well. And so that what happened last meeting doesn't happen again. And I don't mean just, poor Mr. Jensen was just sitting here and listened to this, but the non-transparency piece, you know, I have to agree, felt very set up. And, and I thought that's what we were all striving never to do. Everybody's been really thinking it's very important that we're transparent in what we do. And I will try my best to forward anything I get that needs to be circulated so that doesn't happen. But, So we had a motion on the floor. Can you repeat it?
The motion was to accept it, but didn't we say that we wanted to defer it for the week? You have to withdraw your motion. Someone has to withdraw the second. Who was it? I'll withdraw mine as well.
Okay.
Yes?
So I want to say that if we are going to talk about amending the guidelines, we also want to address the issue of the capitalized dollar amount, because that wasn't honored last year either. So that should be on the table for everybody to consider about what it should really be. If it's not $25,000, what should it be? If we're going to have these guidelines.
Yeah, and I think that goes back to if we had at our first meeting actually make that part of the first meeting is looking over the guidelines, that would have come up and we probably would have addressed it then. So I think, we can certainly address it now, but I think the once a year thing is a good idea. Because that would have pulled it out at that time, and it wouldn't be an issue now. I don't think it would be an issue. So do we want to have everybody think about that as well? There's another number or a figure? Okay.
Is the motion adjourned in order?
No.
No,
there's
one. The consistent budget reporting that Kim had asked about, along with the RSA that Vern had sent. I sent it somewhere. Which we kind of talked, Bill had brought up earlier, stole Kim's thunder. But if you want to talk about your request.
I think it's pretty much in line with what Bill said. If we can see that in, I think, in its budgets, definitely. A little bit of that when Suzanne first started, but now it's different, it's completely different. So we don't see any trend, we don't see any history there, and I think we need to see history across, and it needs to be a consistent format across all the departments.
And all the programs.
Yeah, and all the programs, right. Yes.
Is someone going to take on that task of coming up with the format?
Well, I think the format,
yeah,
what we see mostly from the town is prior year approved, expenditures year to date, proposed budget, and you know, so that you see some trending.
I'll send an email of what I would like to see.
I mean, I agree, and despite the fact that you don't really see the results of it, I mean, we've made some attempts to try to make that happen. So I fully concur. I like the town's format and would like to continue to use that format, which has the, you know, last year's appropriations, expenditures to date. Now, the to date changes depending on when we do the report.
Right.
So we would put, for example, for these things, the quarter three expenditures. You know.
Why can we not get year to date out of that brand new system?
It requires some work. It doesn't come out directly into that Excel spreadsheet.
That's okay. It doesn't have to be. I mean, if you just brought us year to date for all the departments by line, we can resolve that.
Oh, you have no idea what that looks like.
I do, because I worked on that.
No, you worked on a pinch chart.
Well, it's got to be. Well, I know how the line items work, and I understand all of that. So.
Yeah, that's an interesting proposal.
Judy, I would like to ask that the school be exempt, and that we use our regular format that we've been using for.
Your format does follow that. It's prior year.
Yes, but it's not exactly. But if we're going to have a template, it's not going to be on that template.
Well, I mean, switching columns is minor detail. I mean, if it's got substantially the same
data from there. It's about the data, right?
Yeah, it's about the data and the trending.
But some of the other departments are going to need probably some help, right?
In a couple of years to get the, you know, the history in there.
Right.
I mean, ideally, I'd love to see like 3 or 4 years, you know, past right. And then where we are now. Mm-hmm. And then each year you drop off the old, you know, the mm-hmm. oldest year and
right.
just kind of.
Right, we do with the state, we go back from 14 to current. So what's that, 4 years? So we're always a year ahead.
So I think, you know, it's probably a little late in the game, but not completely late for these departments to put in at least this last year and current expenditures.
Last
or Suzanne can bring in current expenditures when she comes.
Last year's approved budget for department, I think what you're saying, right?
Yes.
At least that.
Yes. And then, and right.
So I think to put it in layman terms for, you know, the rec committee, the library, you know, the police and fire kind of have you guys to help them, but to give them some, you know, I almost have a template, like a, yes,
yeah.
something that they could work from with the understanding that it doesn't have to mirror Suzanne's, like Judy's doesn't, but Judy has all the same information, but
exactly.
giving them a starting point because they're not going to know where to start,
yes.
I don't think.
So just as a point of information, we, the town, don't maintain the detailed for like the cemetery trustees,
right.
the library trustees, or the recreation committee.
Right.
So they have their own detailed budgets, which they formulate so that they can use them. They're for their own benefit. And so that's the, you know, they're not like a department. They're not like the police department. It's going to be easy for us to get the police and the fire into a common format, and of course the transfer station. And the
right, which is my point. These little committees are going to need something to talk about.
It isn't necessarily the format as much as it is the data, the trends, the history. You know, so if it comes in three separate sheets for last year, this year, you know, it's fine. Well, I prefer not that, but for some of these smaller departments where they may not have a template, at least providing the data for previous years.
Well, I mean, if we're going to ask for consistency, we should give them something to look at to start with.
An exemplar.
I think it's setting them up for failure if we don't.
But in the very end of the process, it's all on one budget,
mm-hmm.
which is submitted by the Board of Selectmen.
Yes.
So it's all there. So if you take last year's and
We don't have the detail on the life. I mean.
Right.
Not library. It's a single line item.
Or cemetery. Right.
And that's a single line item, as well as recreation is a single line item.
Yeah.
And I mean, if they present with you their budget and how they got to that line item, that's what you'd have to use, because in the budget that is submitted by the Board of Selectmen, it's just $1 amount, one line, for several of the committees. So if they had a copy of last year's budget, which they can manipulate, so to say, to starting to do that, it shouldn't be that hard for them to,
right.
to yeah, just pull their
they
their
have
part.
It now.
Right,
yeah, they
right.
Have it. That's how you.
So, Vern, you're the library trustee. I'm sure you can pull out the line item breakdown for the last couple of years, right?
Yep.
Yeah. You could help. You could help them, I'm sure.
But is there, if we're going to, like, I could send out something for people to start using, or we could give it to them as they come in to say, this is what we want to use next year. But I just feel like we should have something that isn't up here. It's got to be more tangible so that they have something to work.
That would be great.
Mm-hmm. And I'm That's not the person to do it.
You should yourself as well.
No. I said I'm not the person to do it. And
Well, no, you're not an attachments person. You have an AOL account, so you're
I do have an AOL account, and it sends an attachment every second email.
No, you're right. No, it's an attachment.
Honestly. But is there somebody who could do up a...
I think Burns being volunteered.
Okay.
No, I've got all the data from the library,
the
so it's easy.
I like the town's format.
Exactly. That's what we should be continuing to
Can you send an example of that? An email, and then...
Well, you've got it right here. Let's send out.
Can we get a blank one?
The quarterly?
Yeah.
The quarterly or the annual report?
It's the same. It's essentially the same.
Same
minor variations. But
yeah. Yeah. Last year, this year, year-to-date expenditure, proposed budget.
Mm-hmm. So they could
start. But they had a blank one with the heading.
You could provide them with a blank one.
Or
you could bring a blank one next time.
It's only 2 years of data, though. It's 16 appropriation and expenditures and current year appropriation and expenditures.
Well,
I think
you have more than that. You're going to have to be on, like, legal size paper. I mean...
No, I mean, some of these
to read
columns,
it, yes.
You don't need some of these columns, though. Some of the
mm-hmm.
columns that are in here you don't need. But I would like to see 2015 actuals.
It sounds to me like Kim it really wants to do it. She wants it. She wants certain things, and she
I know
wants
I want
to change
for
columns.
Data.
So
yeah.
why don't why?
I'll tell you what I want for
so
data.
So it sounds like
that.
Kim should do it. I mean, the person who has the clearest vision of what they want should.
I mean, it's just not going to happen this year. I mean, it just isn't sufficient time. But it's something we can work on for next year.
Mm-hmm. Then that's fine. But for future budgets this year, can we come with this data so I don't have to look at the quarterly, look at the annuals? And then look at their budget.
I thought you just said it was fine to have them on separate pieces. I mean, that's the problem. The problem is, you know, the data exists on separate pieces.
Well, this data isn't the same as the quarterlies.
So what do we have left? We have left cemetery that's already been submitted. We have sewer and water.
And
town and highway are together, and they're already
they're
in a format that you like.
By that time, you see the highway and the
and school, which is already in a format that you mm-hmm. like. So
and
I mean, rat. We're not that much left. We don't have much
left. And rec is part of the
town.
We don't have the detail. We're just going to see summer. We're going to see camper only and the teen camp.
Yes,
and then other lines like the winter rec.
So when you come with highway, we'll see at least 2 years and expenditures.
We'll be showing you, it's exactly what you see in there, because that's the point right now.
How come police and fire didn't come with that then?
Well,
it's a long story.
All due respect, though, they never did, Kim.
Right.
They always submitted their own paperwork. And then when it all got through the budget committee, then it went on to the Board of Selectmen, and they put it as part of their total budget. What they did tonight, they've always done.
Mm-hmm.
They've always done it. But, you'll see the detail once it gets loaded into the selectman's budget. And when it's
Which is
ready right. for the end of the process and getting things approved, you're going to have the data.
Which is why I said I really wanted to wait, because none of these folks have been doing it that way. So to spring it on them this soon particularly well, left yesterday.
I think if we say we are looking for people to be consistent in their reporting, and we'd like you to make every reasonable effort to try and have it like this, please, if you need help, let us know. Otherwise, it's going to be next July before we start seeing more data, or next fall, and it'll be forgotten.
I think we tell them the format, like, we're telling them next year we're going to have a format for you,
right.
And we'll have templates for you early on, so they can start
right
at the beginning of the year.
Right, because you can't wait till the end. Let them have a chance to get used to it and fill it in. And
they have to plan for completing it as well, so if we give them the format at the beginning of the year, they can track their expenses in whatever way they need to in order to fill that format.
Right.
But I really think they need a template to start from. I think it would be, this has come up, obviously, if you remember, years ago, and if you don't give people a hard picture of what you want, you're going to get stuff that's all over the place because everybody's got their creative way to do things. So I think to make it easier on them and us, we should come up with this is what we're looking for, you know, as best you can. Knowing that
Lynn's a format,
mm-hmm.
And the one thing it doesn't have is more than 2 years, and so we can think about how best to do that. But it's just not going to happen this year. It's already in place.
But
I mean,
you could
down.
Use that template for all, I mean,
yes.
I don't care who does it or how it comes,
right.
But I'm just saying I think we need to give
right.
people something to work on.
I think Kim already agreed to do that, right?
I'll try to do it by the first of the year.
I like the town format.
I do.
You
could just
copy that,
and she's going to
have it. You know, that's easy enough. I just blank it out, and we can give it to people.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know why any extra work has to happen.
Mm-hmm. And add a column for the other year.
Right.
You mean it's on a blank, that's easy.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we could ditch some of the columns. Like, we have appropriation, expenditures to date for 2016, balance available, and percent expended. I think you could ditch. You know,
that isn't there in the final report. It really is just the expenditures to date. You're looking at the quarter three?
Yes.
So once we do there are those differences. Once we do the budget that we'll present to the budget committee, the prior year has the actuals through whatever the date is. You know,
mm-hmm.
either November 30th or if we're it's the final budget, it will be through unaudited December 31st.
So you basically would have like approved and expended for 2016 and 15, and then your current
right.
year.
Not this year, but
right.
yes.
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Perfect.
Now motion to adjourn.
Yes,
I'm going to ask for the town's inventory.
We're working on it.
Okay. I want you working on it.
Yeah.
Oh, I would just like to have it before the 6th, and that's 2 weeks.
1 week.
Oh, please.
The 6th, this
one. Wait a minute. No. It's cemetery, water, and rec tomorrow, next week. And then we go to the school.
And then we come.
It was 3 weeks.
Yeah.
No, that's fine.
All your vehicles are in your auditor's report.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah.
Through
that,
isn't it?
Just
a question for Wednesday's in we have a budget for the communications line item. What is the process for adjusting that? Do we need to do it in this meeting when we look at the budget?
The budget committee should
make a motion.
Should make a motion to
when we are reviewing the budget.
Yes, you can do it then. It'd be nice to have done it ahead of time only because, you know, we've already at a point where we're finalizing everything. So
I'd like to make a motion to increase the budget committee communication line item to $500.
I have no idea what she's talking about.
We have a line item. It's called budget committee communication.
And what does that mean?
Hang on. Do we have a second?
Wait.
A second.
So just
to
have
for
the discussion. What is it for?
It's for, well, actually, last year it was for putting out meeting notices.
Okay.
But basically, communicating to the community budget committee information.
And you're asking for it to be increased?
Yes.
And what for?
So we can communicate with the rest of the community budget information.
But what's the cost for it?
Right.
Yeah.
If we want to, for example, send them information about the warrants that will be going on,
you know, the select board will do its voting guide. Right.
Yeah, that voting guide was really lax. It had missing information. It didn't even talk about when they were voting on things. It only talked about public hearings. So either there needs to be some process where we agree and review it and say, yes, it seems to have all the information that we think the town needs, or we need to do a better job.
I think a voting guide belongs to the select board. It's a governance issue, and it's the select board's prerogative to get out the word on what it believes the voters will be voting on.
Can we have a review process now?
I don't know. Let me think about this. And I'm, the only reason I'm saying that is because I want to make sure that the select board is not giving up any rights and duties and privileges that it has.
Oh, no. Whatever document would come from the budget committee would be approved by this committee. The whole committee would have to say, yes, that looks like good information. Yes, we should share it. So it would
be, it's not at electioneering.
Right, no. It would be a very neutral document, and it has to be approved to be sent out by this committee.
I think we shouldn't vote tonight on this. I think you should come in with more information of why you want to increase it and what it definitely is entailing to. And secondly, I think if you're going to put out a document by the budget committee, it also needs to be reviewed by the Board of Selectmen and the school board, if that has anything to do with the school board.
Yeah.
Because when you put something out mass mailing, it reflects the Board of Selectmen and the school board, not the budget committee, even though you put your names on it, the budget committee did this. They're going to come to these people, so they need the blessing as well.
That's fine. And then, like I said, it has to be approved by everybody if it's going to blow. That's all I'm saying.
I guess I understand the idea of trying to get the information out. It's I see, you know, it's coming from here, it's coming from there. It's the same information. Is it only that we just want information to the public, correct?
It really is.
And you were not satisfied with last year. Well, last year
it wasn't neutral enough, and it lacked information. It didn't even have a voting day on it.
Right.
Or a voting location.
Last year was our first year of doing that, so maybe we can tweak it and make it better.
Neutral. It was not a neutral document.
Okay.
Can I say that the board is not neutral? That the board, in fact, has some opinions that it does want to make available to the public.
But it's our budget.
You've got to be aware that it's got to be totally neutral, otherwise you're going to get charged with electioneering. Now, Newmarket School Board got slapped with a cease and desist because of that. They said, we're going to be voting on this bond issue, and this is important because, and the Attorney General came down and said, no, you are not going to do that. That's electioneering.
So we're not allowed to say why the board thinks it's important to do something?
No.
Public hearing,
but you can't. Look, 669, something or other. You want to be very careful about that.
So my thought about this document is all it does is it states the warrant articles, the financial warrant articles that will be voted on, the date and times of the locations that they'll be voting on it. That's it. No commentary on why you should vote one way or another.
Right.
It's just informing people about what's going on in town.
So why not just send a copy of the articles up for a vote and just send that copy?
Warrant.
I mean, it's the same thing.
Well, it's send a warrant.
Like the ballot.
You have to send a copy of that. Oh, to everybody?
No, just the warrant articles. Just the warrant.
The warrant.
Just the warrants.
Yeah, that's all that would be in it is a description of the warrant.
Well, not just the warrant. As soon as you start describing, then you're adding something to it.
Right.
So,
interpretation.
Yes.
You want to tread that very carefully.
Well, that's the point I'm trying to make, that we send out the warrant, period.
That's
here's
it.
Where
it
we vote,
that's
here's
it.
The warrant.
It could be that. But whatever it is, it's approved by this committee below.
It's a warrant. You don't approve the warrant.
Well,
you'll
say whether you support it or not. And then once it's been voted on whether you support or not support, it's on there. Are you going to just make a copy of the warrant paid?
Well, I'm not even saying that we should send out the warrant that has been determined to be supported or not. Just something that describes it to people. So when they get it, they can read it over, they can ask questions, they can email, they can walk in, whatever. They have time to think about what they're voting on, They know where they're voting and what they're voting on.
Okay, but you can't send out a document unless it's been voted on by the Budget Committee and the Board of Selectmen. Because, no, you're sending out wrong information.
No, I agree.
Oh, okay. So that's what I'm saying. Once it's been gone through the whole process, the Budget Committee process, it will say whether it was approved or not approved by the Budget Committee. And then you just make a copy of that. It's what you would get at the polls.
It's the warrant.
And you're just going to send it out. That's
yes.
it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah. That's
yeah.
it.
It's what's posted everywhere.
Right.
It's posted.
Right.
It's
put on the website. It's the warrant.
So, I mean, if you want it as black and white, that's it.
That's the warrant.
Well, I think that's all you can do.
Right.
As soon as you start editorializing,
mm-hmm.
there's going to be
yes.
nuances. And
right.
There's going to be slants. And somebody's going to say it appears to lean
mm-hmm.
one way or the other.
And
so
that's electioneering.
Mm-hmm. So was there not enough? Is there not enough money to do that? At the current budget?
Probably not, especially if you do the warrant. I don't know how many pages that would be, but.
Yes. I guess, what do you propose to do? Mail it to everybody in town?
We did it, well, they did it with the flyer last year. It just, the flyer was not complete, and it had opinions in it.
Hmm. How much was the flyer?
It came out of the regular postage.
$215 for just for the postage, and then there's the printing cost.
What'd you say, $250?
$215 about.
$215 to send it to town.
$215.
Yeah. Yeah.
Covers the town.
Yeah.
Then
yeah.
Printing
right.
costs are about the same, so $300 ain't gonna cut it.
Yep.
And then we still have to do signs. Tell people, oh, Scott, there's going to be a town meeting this Saturday.
So you're proposing like an over 50% increase to your budget loan.
That's right. Damn right. Everybody's got their part. We want ours.
I guess I do have a bit of an issue with that, because the democratic process, to me, means if you want information, you got to go look for it. So if we throw all this stuff out there, I mean, people are going to show up in the mailbox. They're going to throw it out.
Mm-hmm.
They're not going to read it. But if you really want to know, you're going to look at the website. You're going to do stuff. You're going to affirmatively try to get this information. I think that says something to the,
We have an older population in this town. I know for a fact my dad can't even turn on a computer.
Yep.
You know, so, Charlie,
he can,
you know,
he starts hitting him on that.
You know what?
But, okay.
Barrington sends out, and I gave this is a very comprehensive document. I don't understand why we wouldn't make more of an effort to communicate with the people that live in this town, especially since it's an older population. They still read newspapers.
So we do provide a newsletter with our tax bills for that very reason. It's not the voter's guide. We're trying to increase communication to those people who don't look at computers. So there's the quarterly that comes out twice a year. we're about, I think, to kind of forget the name.
You let third graders name it.
Yeah, we're going to just call it the Seven Falls.
I think
newsletter.
You should keep it that way.
I applaud any way to get information out to the voters. I think that if it's just going to be a copy of the ballot, then a warrant articles, which is the ballot. I mean, yeah, you don't have to do necessarily who's running for office, I guess. I mean, that's something we can talk about as we go forward. I believe we have a motion on the floor, which I would like to, I think, has to now be taken back.
No.
Okay.
So you want to vote? Call a vote.
What are we voting on?
Yeah.
What's the motion?
Just an increase from $300 to $500 in the budget communication line.
Well, I'll place an amendment that we defer it until the next meeting. I mean, it's no different than the previous one we talked about in depth as well. We should be making a quick decision.
The thing about deferral was only for changes to the guidelines. This is not a change to the guidelines.
Well, and I would have been fine for the next meeting, but Suzanne just said she would have liked to know earlier. So that's why I proposed it today. It wasn't planned. It was a question. How do we do this? How do we ask you for a little bit more money to communicate with the town?
You go to the Board of Selectmen. Let me just answer it just the way I would answer it. So we would normally send out an email to people who provide budgets so that they can return them to us by a certain date. So what I need to do is include the Budget Committee as part of that, which we didn't do immediately. So it would be in response to that. But it's a $300 line, and it is honestly escaping me.
Okay. I would go to vote.
I want more depth about what they want to increase it and what it would be used for. I mean, that's the request I'm asking for.
Yeah, it's a big, I mean, for not, for pretty vague answers.
Well, I just told you exactly what it would be, and we agree it would be the warrant with your voting times and locations.
But we have no idea how much that's going to cost. I think we need to look at that further before we increase it.
Yeah. And do we know what we spent out of that line last year? Is $500 sufficient to do this? That would, again, the same thing. Can we do it with what we have? Or?
You know what? If it goes over a little bit, they'll do what they do with everything else. They'll drop you some money around. But I don't think it's real significant. So, anyways, there's an amendment on the floor.
You've got a call.
Call a question.
And then. I think we need to defer it until the next. More information is provided in writing so we all understand what they're looking. It's last minute.
You need a second? Okay. Could you get a motion to amend?
I'll vote on the amendment to
defer it to next year's more information in writing. It is given to us so we can understand.
Do we need a
vote on the amendment first?
You have to vote on the amendment first.
Okay. So a question, I'm not sure of the question. To increase, the amendment is to increase the $300.
No, the amendment is to defer it to the next meeting so documentation can be in writing and given to every member to know what they're voting for. That's the amendment.
That's the amendment.
And it's been seconded.
So do
you voting on the amendment now?
Roll call or do you want?
Of course, you want a roll call.
Call started over here. Yes, sir.
Yes.
If you want.
Yes,
to defer.
Mm-hmm. He said yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
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 Yes. Okay. So I will put it in writing.
Thank you.
And I think there's a lot of information we're going to need. Like, are we going to form a committee who's going to be in charge of this? Or are we just expecting the chair to do it, for instance? I mean, I think these things are important to know before we, you know, increase someone's workload or something, too. So, you know,
not that complicated. Sort of really, it's really simple.
But there still needs a process to have it done. Right. You can throw it out and say, well, it's really simple, and then weeks will go by, and who's doing it? I mean, you need a process. That's all I'm saying.
We need someone to be responsible. We need
yeah,
to know
who's
responsible.
You need a responsible party.
I know, but to do what?
Whatever it is you're proposing we do as a committee.
Now,
oh, yeah, gotcha.
Now you
yeah.
got to vote on the main question.
Oh, yeah, now you have to vote up, but it includes it being
deferred
to the next meeting. You have to vote again on the amendment.
Okay.
That's been approved
okay.
for the article.
I'm very confused by that.
Okay, the article is amended. So that the amendment got approved. Now you have to
vote
on the
main question.
The main question.
The main question at this point.
To increase it by
$500. I don't want to do that. I want to defer.
No, but
so how did this be?
Well, now it's deferred that they want to increase it to $500, but it's been amended to have deferred to the next week. That's what you're talking about. Right? So,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Most of
it's deferred.
Looking
at poor Corey Shaker.
Most of deferred. Now, what's the problem?
Yeah.
The main
motion
is
deferred. Yes.
Yeah. So we're done.
You can't do that with amendment, but okay.
We're done. Right, so we weren't perfect, but I think we know. I think we all have agreed. We're going to think about it. We're going to come back next time.
I will write it out.
Motion to adjourn then?
Yes, just to make sure everybody. No, I just want to make sure everybody knows. Cemetery, water, sewer, and rec is next meeting on the 6th.
Thank you.
And I will second.
Did we vote to adjourn?
Yeah.
Do we want to discuss voting to adjourn?
All right, good.
We haven't adjourned yet, guys.
And a motion and a second on the floor. All the vote.
All in favor?